I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo stove, fixed fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention Love20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
Unfortunately, what you're about to hear is real. The members of this radio program are simply not that bright, or what some people would call educated. They are merely stupid. They're not trying to offend anyone on purpose. And all have played doctors on TV. You have been warned and are cordially invited to join the party. This is the Men's Room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. The trippers, the grasshoppers, the hip ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. You know what they say, shake your radio more than three times, and you're playing with it. You're listening to the Men's Room.
And away we go. Welcome to season 18 and episode number 4012. Along with Steve the Thrill Hill. Yeah. Okay. T. Chad Smith. Woo! And my car. Montgomery! On the Men's Room.
There you go.
On tap today, we celebrate the Pac-12 Championship.
On a Bad Choice Friday.
The return of Ted versus the FCC. Plus headlines, Men's Room Shot of the Day, fundable listener emails, and everyone's favorite, TV Time with Ted.
Click, clack, drinkity John.
All right, hurry. Here we go. Florida man with no life is trying to collect 1 million copies of Titanic on VHS. Meanwhile, Florida man with no life steals hundreds in Pokemon cards, and ladies, he will not impress. Woman steals $800 worth of Barbies before leading police on a high-speed chase. If you see a bear at the Quick Trip in Oregon, they say, give him a little space. And shocking news is even a Baltimore City worker corrupt. That is all coming on today's very special episode of The Men's Room.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours on a positive Friday. Positive. Thank you, Mike. Now, everyone on this show, we'll bet everyone else on the show about pretty much anything. Why? Well, obviously the bragging rights and smack talk, but also because our standard bet is exactly $1. One. Now, what we would never do is bet $100,000, but then again, we're not rich. Eddie Murphy, on the other hand, along with the late Richard Pryor, yeah, they're filthy rich, and that's why Richard Pryor bet Eddie $100,000 that Eddie would never release an album of all music and no comedy. All right, that was the bet. Well, in 1985, Eddie did just that, put out a music album. It was terrible, but he put it out. But long story short, Pryor never paid Eddie the $100,000, and then he died. So he won the bet, but he never got the money. Now, oddly enough, a man in Pittsburgh at a casino there, he lost his bet, but still won over $360,000. In a nutshell, dude's playing poker, and he was feeling real good about his chances because he was holding four aces. But he lost to a royal flush. Now, the good news is that triggered the bad beat jackpot, which basically means that everyone at the table won money. And that's why he walked with over $360,000, which is not bad for losing. But that said, it's still a lot more fun to win. Imagine winning $1.35 billion through the lottery. Well, a man did exactly that. And like me, he did not want anyone to know. But unfortunately, his baby mama couldn't keep her mouth shut, in spite of signing an NDA. So now his family knows, which has led to the types of complications that only money can create. And that's what we're talking about today. Money, moolah, banknotes, cheddar, Benji's, capital, bread, gravy, greenbacks, dough, loot, whatever you want to call it. You want to add anything, Ted? I feel like you probably have more slang for cash than any of us.
Racks.
Like I said, I knew there had to be at least one more. Today, we are talking
cheddar.
About cheddar. Yeah. Cheese. So today, we're talking about money, and that's what our question is. Good or bad, what's your best story involving money?
To be a part of the big show, call 206-803-ROCK. You can like the Men's Room on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live, and send your emails to themensroom at KISW.com.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo stove, fixed fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault? Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Deep underground, the Jelly Belly Factory, BB is in her secret laboratory creating the weird and wild flavors of Bean Boozled.
I've done it again!
Is it pomegranate or old bandage? Dare to compare. Bean Boozled, 6th edition. Are you brave enough?
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Home Patrol's away we go. Welcome to Season 18, Episode number 4012. What a large and in charge program we have for you today.
You think so?
Guaranteed future repeat on the social positive Friday.
Positive Absolutely. Friday.
Yes, we made it to December.
Oh, hell, with today, yeah, December 1st.
Yes, right? It's December.
It is December.
That's crazy, man.
My kids seem to think that means Christmas happens tomorrow. Yeah.
We are counting down the days to the very last Ted versus the FCC of the year.
Ooh, that is right.
And as you know, in our year in Spectacular, we play every miss in Ted versus the FCC. It has been a while since we tallied up the wins and the losses. We're going to take a look at that before we get to the end of the year.
I do know that we will hear about Helen Hunt plenty.
Yes, we will. But I will tell you this. We were up way too late last night coming up with tongue twisters and rhymes and riddles for Ted and Ted versus the FCC. Ted, you're not going to believe this. We came in this morning and we got a listener submitted Ted versus the FCC from a guy named Maxwell. So we're going to go with that as we always say, the listener comes first. So you're
Would you go by Maxwell if your name's Maxwell? I mean, just call me Max. I don't think if my name were Maxwell that I'd want to be called Maxwell.
Would you be paranoid? Would you feel like someone's always watching
me? Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, Max. He is a sexy R&B singer.
Is he? Is he still Ted?
Yeah.
Okay. You'll see him in a hot 103.7 concert coming around the area shortly with seven other people. So the exciting return of Ted versus the FCC coming up. Of course, as we do every Monday through Friday, lucky you, you get more Men's Room exclusively on Odyssey. And the Odyssey app joins us today for the Men's Room Happy Hour in episode number 505, where my guess is we'll be talking a little college football.
More likely.
That is just my guess coming up with the Men's Room Happy Hour. If you don't have the Odyssey app downloaded now, it's absolutely free. Search for the Men's Room. You're going to find everything Men's Room on one page, including the Men's Room radio station. Mm-hmm. Give us a chance to come up with some of our own musical favorites and put them on a channel, so we have a music channel there.
We have to remember to update that.
That's exactly right. I've got all the weekly podcasts, the podcast, mega podcast, greatest story never told podcast, best of weekly podcast, daily podcast, all in one place. And, of course, there's the Men's Room Happy Hour channel. And we'll go live there at 6 o'clock. So hope to see you there. Speaking of a little bit of football action, of course, we will drink and toast into the weekend with a shot of the day. Then it's Bad Choice Friday time.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
It's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Hey, man, this is your fault.
Jam on. And today we celebrate the Pac-12 championship on a Bad Choice Friday. As you know, the Oregon Ducks taking on the Washington Huskies. So why not a little Weird Al Yankovic?
I want a new duck. One that won't try to bite. One that won't chew a hole in my socks. One that won't quack all night. I want a new duck. One with big web feet.
This was our best duck option, Ted. Just so you know, we thought about Disco Duck from Rick Dees, but we thought Weird Al's better. I want a new duck.
I like this one.
What a new duck. I want a new duck.
I had never heard the song before, but it's easy to sing along.
Yes, exactly. I kind of have an idea where they're going.
Right.
I just don't know all the lyrics, but yes. Weird Al Yankovic, and I want a new duck, taking on the Baja Man.
It's hard to find a song with the word husky in it. It's just not a popular lyric.
No, it is not. Baja Man and Who Let the Dogs Out, take it on Weird Al Yankovic and I Want a New Duck. Vote now if you happen to follow us on Twitter, Men's Room Live. One of those two tunes coming up right after we drink and toast with a shot of the day.
And just for today and the purposes of the Pac-12 Championship, we're changing the title from Dogs to D-A-W-G Dog.
Ah, yes.
Oh, okay,
yes.
Who Let the Dogs Out.
Name one other song from Baja Man.
That's right.
There's one about a frisbee, I forget.
About a frisbee?
Or a boomerang, I don't remember. They tried another one and it didn't work.
I know it didn't work because I can't think of another song from Baja Man.
Exactly.
And our question today, we're going to talk a little bit about money. Money can go a lot of different ways. Ted, I know you were just telling us the other day your philosophy as far as lending money during TV time with Ted.
Your philosophy is don't.
The guy from Shark Tank said, look, man, I'm willing to give a family member a one-time loan under the conditions, basically, that A, it is a gift and not a loan, and B, we never talk about the loan ever again, and
right.
Whatever the other thing was, but it was basically like, look, I will loan you this money, but it is a gift.
Right.
And once we do this, the other part was, I will only do this once.
One time.
So I'll only do this one time. We will never talk about it again, and it is a gift. I think those were the stipulations. And Ted, you said that you've loaned some people money before.
I have. I had a buddy that was going through a tough time. I helped him out twice, and then I said, okay, no more money.
Right.
And then, when he gets drunk and brings it up, I said, hey, part of the deal is I don't care. If you loan money to a friend or family member, expect it not to come back, but also, like, I don't want to talk about it. Like, that money's gone to me.
That's right. What I think you really have to mentally for yourself, even if they're saying, it's a loan, I'll pay you back. Don't believe that.
No.
You have to convince yourself that it is a gift.
Because if you don't take a loan, let the bank do the loan. If you're the bank, it's a gift.
This is a gift.
And if it comes back to you,
cool.
It is a gift as well.
But if I convince myself that it's a gift, then I have no expectations of ever seeing this money again.
Exactly. Exactly. That's exactly how you have to approach it. So we'll start
with my kids. You know, like, Dad, can I borrow $20? I'm like, you understand that borrow would suggest that in some way I'm going to get paid back for this.
Right.
You just want $20. Tell me what it's for, and I'll think about it. But this is not a loan.
You never say, can I borrow a cigarette? You say, can I get one off of you?
Well, people see
it. You're never paying it back.
Well, they'll say, hey, man, do you have an extra cigarette? Like, no, I had 20 in the pack, as they often are, but I will give you one. But it's not extra.
I didn't get 21 this time.
Yeah.
Basically, that's it. We head to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. A poker player at the Rivers Casino suffered a bad beat on Tuesday night when his four aces lost to a royal flush, making everyone at the table a winner when the bad beat jackpot was triggered. It was triggered when Scott Thompson of Washington, PA, which is not too far away from where I grew up, had four aces that were beat by Brent Enos of Jefferson Hills royal flush at the Rivers Casino. When a hand of four of a kind, tens or higher, are beat by an even higher hand, the jackpot is triggered, making everyone at the table a winner. Now, the player who suffered the bad beat, he takes home 40% of the jackpot.
Jesus.
The player with the winning hand takes 30%.
Wait.
And everyone else at the table split the rest equally.
So wait, if I win it, I get 30%.
You get 40.
No, if I win, I get 30. The guy that lost
you're
got
right.
40.
You're right. The bad beat takes home the 40%. That is correct. When the jackpot was hit on Tuesday, it was worth $905,622. Thompson's losing hand of four aces earned him the 40% total.
Which is crazy to me.
$362,000. While Enos, he took home $271,000. And everyone else at the table took over just over $45,000. Now, they say this is not the first time a bad beat jackpot has made people at the Rivers Casino big winners. Last year, a jackpot of $1.2 million was triggered when four aces were also beat by a royal flush, making a West Virginia man $500,000 richer.
Damn.
We are unexpectedly and happily becoming a national bad beat jackpot hotspot, according to Bud Green. And yes, his name is Bud Green.
Bud Green, damn.
Who is the general manager at Rivers Casino Pittsburgh. Congratulations to our winning guests and to our Rivers Pittsburgh Poker Room team members for doing a terrific job. The bad beat jackpot progressive was reset following the big win at the table on Tuesday night and has already started climbing again. As people now want to get in on that action, understanding?
Yeah, I bet they do.
What could basically happen?
I mean, if I made 45 grand just because I was present at the table, I want to play at that table. I still don't understand how the guy with the losing hand gets more money than the guy with the winning hand.
It's crazy.
That just makes no sense to me.
Now, here's a very weird one for you. But as you know, when it comes to family, there are some issues that involve money.
Always.
Depending on the situation. Well, years after the legal battle over a massive T-Rex skeleton was resolved, the heirs of the couple that claimed the skeleton are fighting over money. Sue, ironically enough, the largest and most complete T-Rex skeleton ever discovered was found in 1990 on the property of Maurice and Darlene Williams. Now, that was in the Cheyenne River Reservation in South Dakota.
All right.
After legal fights over ownership rights were resolved, Sue was sold for $7.6 million in 1997. Now, Maurice Williams died in 2011. Darlene Williams died in 2020. But the couple have four children, and they're fighting over the second of her two wills. In a 2017 will, Williams planned to give each of her daughters a diamond ring, and each of her grandchildren would receive equal shares of her estate.
Okay.
It named her daughter as the person in charge of settling the estate. But then there was a second will that was drawn up less than 3 weeks before her death, when, as they said, she was not exactly lucid. And it names Luther as the sole heir and executor.
Damn Luther.
The typed document states that Williams doesn't want her children to fight, and she hopes her death will bring harmony to the family after years of disagreements. By the way,
years of disagreements about what? It's
siblings,
her money.
The siblings all admitted that there had never been any disagreements between any of the siblings.
Oh, really?
Up until this point, when a second will was drawn up, it was all supposed to be spread equally.
And you said the second will was drawn up 3 weeks before her death when she's a little out of it.
Correct. Court documents say the daughter, Jacqueline Schwartz, is challenging the second will, arguing that it might not be legal because her mother was critically ill when she signed it. And there are also no witnesses on the signature because of COVID restrictions. She is challenging the sale of her mother's former home weeks before her death. According to court records, the house sold for $225,000, and the sale went to Carson Williams, one of Williams' two sons.
All right.
So basically, people are going in and grabbing the money from this family.
Not the first time I've heard this.
As the woman that has passed on.
It's one thing. My parents, you know, because they're in their 80s now, so you cannot have a conversation with them that does not involve their imminent death. You know, it's like, dude, we understand how life works. Quit bringing it up. But then again, in your 80s, I get it. So my mother explained, hey, we did the will, and both my brother and I said, you don't owe us anything. We're freaking adults, man. You don't owe us anything. You already spent more money on us than anyone should have to, just based on the fact that we're your kid. We don't need anything from you. If you want to leave something, fine, but really, don't worry about that. So they've drawn up the will, and I don't know what's in it. I do not care. But they said, well, we made your brother the executor. I said, you should, because he'll get around to it. He'll do a good job. We all understand that. But we had said to them years ago, do not concern yourself with leaving us money. We are adults. We can figure it out. And we don't want any kind of infighting and all that. Not that my brother and I are those people, but inevitably these things happen. So when they retired, my father was talking to a financial planner. He was kind of explaining their situation, blah, blah, blah. And I don't know how much money they get a year or whatever. My dad goes, all right, cool, because we're going to try to spend it all. And according to my mother, the financial guy, he laughed, thinking my father was joking. He said, your father was so stoked. He said, I'm not kidding. Our kids already told us, don't worry about it. And he clearly is not worried about it.
Right.
That's what he told us. It's your money. Go spend it on whatever you guys want to do. I don't want any infighting, any of this dumbass stuff that happens when people die. It is amazing.
Yep. It's crazy.
You know what? My brother was the executive of my dad's will. But same thing. Me and my brother get along. So, like, he would call me for, like, advice. I'm like, you're taking care of him. Like, spend it.
Yeah, that's fair. Right? So there's no infighting, exactly. Right?
Yeah, and, like, little things, right? Like, my dad was on his last legs. My brother was like, hey, I'm going to take some of the money and buy Maryland basketball tickets. Hopefully he makes it to a game. I was like, yeah, sure, go ahead. Like, who cares?
Yeah, I think that's the way to do it.
Did he make it to a game, or was it too far past that point?
You know what, Miles? I will say my brother and a lot of his friends really enjoyed those seats.
Okay, all right. Oh, okay. Well, that's not a bad way to spend money, then. You know?
No. And they were good seats because my dad was having trouble getting around. So they're like top row, right in front of the beer section, so they wouldn't have to walk much.
Oh, so it was close to handicap, but not exactly handicap.
Correct.
Okay. That's pretty strong. Now, Ted, did your dad like have any secret stash of anything that you guys didn't know about, like whether it was valuables or cash or anything like that when you ended up going through his home and seeing what he collected throughout the years? Was there anything that surprised you?
We were just surprised how much he stayed on his fixed budget and like didn't spend. Because what was I going to say? I love my mother, but she's the opposite. Like, we're worried she's going to go through her whole retirement before she actually passes. But we were pleasantly surprised with my dad. Like, oh, he stayed within his budget well.
Is there anything you saw that you said, please don't leave that to me in your will?
No. Like, when we cleaned out the house, there was a lot of random stuff. But, like, to be honest with you, there was just so many Maryland jackets and hoodies.
Okay. Had he paid off his mortgage in all those years that you guys have lived in that home? The home you... Because I'm sure growing up, it was probably, what, a $30,000 home?
Probably right around
in
there.
In the 60s or the 70s or whenever they bought that house.
Yeah, I think they paid a little over 40 for it. It was paid off and stuff. We obviously had to put some money into, like, fixing it up and everything and getting it ready to sell. But, no, it worked out well.
Okay. I have never gotten money either through passing or just in general from a relative in my life.
I never have, ever.
I can't even imagine. I don't know. I do know that the inheritance tax in the state of Washington, this is the most expensive state to live in. If you do get inheritance, as far as what they tax you, the percentage is head and shoulders above most other states in the country.
Which is ridiculous. I understand you consider it a source of income, but it's like... This income comes by way of something tragic happening.
If you happen to fall into a lot of money and you don't have money and you live in Washington State, I say you move. I mean, even if you move to Oregon for a year.
Just before you read the will?
Yeah, go rent a place down there, man. Make that your chief primary residence. Rent your place out back here, man, and just stay down there to take the money. Then move back. Then move back when the lease is over again. You don't want any part of that. Our question, good or bad, what is your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Selling a little or a lot? Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business. From the launch your online shop stage, to the first real-life store stage, all the way to the did we just hit a million orders stage. Shopify is here to help you grow. Whether you're selling scented soap or offering outdoor outfits, Shopify helps you sell everywhere. From their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system, wherever and whatever you're selling, Shopify is got you covered. Shopify helps you turn browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout. 15% better on average compared to other leading commerce platforms. And sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the U.S. And Shopify is the global force behind Allbirds, Rothy's, and Brooklinen, and millions of other entrepreneurs of every size across 175 countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning 24/7 help is there to support your success every step of the way. Because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/odyssey podcast, all lowercase. Go to shopify.com/odyssey podcast now to grow your business, no matter what stage you're in. shopify.com/odyssey podcast.
It's time to talk about Felix, the pet insurance brand made just for cats. Starting at under $1 a day, you can get whisker-to-tail protection with a plan as unique as your cat. Sorry, dogs. This customizable coverage is exclusively for feline friends. Learn more at felixcatinsurance.com. That's felixcatinsurance.com. Get it? Meow.
Insurance is underwritten by Independence American Insurance Company and produced by Independence Pet Group. Pre-existing conditions are not covered. Visit felixcatinsurance.com/terms for all terms and limitations.
This holiday season, make your journey memorable with Travel Centers of America. Visit our one-stop shop for all your holiday travel needs. Fuel up, get snacks, and dine at one of our full-service restaurants. Hit the road with peace of mind knowing we've got you covered. Travel Centers of America.
When it comes to getting your gifts packed and shipped this holiday, we're the one-stop right around the corner, everything you need for every way you holiday store. The UPS Store. Be unstoppable.
The UPS Store franchise locations are independently owned. Products, services, prices, and hours may vary. See Center for details.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
A question, good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Tim. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Liquor and whores.
Liquor and whores.
What's up, guys? Hey, real quick, before I tell my story, I just wanted to say I've been listening to you guys for like 10-plus years, and I never put a face to the name, and I Googled you guys the other day.
Uh-oh.
You guys look completely opposite of what I thought you would look
what,
like.
What? Tell me, what images did you have in your head for each one of us?
Attractive people. So I'll start with Ted. So, honestly, Ted looks exactly how I thought he would look like.
Uh-huh. Okay. No,
all right.
Which, no offense, I guess. I don't know. But
well, now it's offensive. No offense. All you said is that he looks like what you thought.
You didn't have to say it, but when you say no offense, that means I'm trying to offend you.
I mean, I know he's a big Sounders fan, and I go to Sounders games, and I see the guys, like, in that area where they're all singing, and, like, I thought he'd look like one of those guys.
He looks like an ECS guy, but he's on the other side.
Yeah.
I am a member of the ECS.
Yeah, well... We'll just call it that. Thrill, I honestly did not know you were black, dude. I thought you were a fat white guy.
Everybody says that. And overalls?
Bro, I thought you were a fat white guy with overalls.
I like that. We can draw that up.
I hear fat white guy a lot. I don't know why, but overalls, bro? I mean, damn, man.
Do you even own overalls?
No, I don't own overalls.
Like, kind of like a redneck Louisiana. I cook a lot. I got a huge beard and glasses. Overall, fat white guy.
Yeah, like
yeah. No, I can picture. But all right. What about Miles?
Let's add some pepper.
And then Miles. I thought Miles looked like one of those like. No offense, also Miles.
Oh, here we go,
sorry, dude. But almost like a male Karen, high HOA. Condominium.
Hey, you need to cut your grass. You need to cut your grass. I'm going to kick you out of here, brother. I'm not kidding.
Do you wear your sweaters around your neck like the Hamptons people do?
No.
He is the farthest thing from that dude.
Typically, I wear a sweater every day like a cardigan.
Yes, every day.
You wear a lot of golf gear, though. It's a thin line.
Yeah, exactly. I do dress kind of like the lead singer of, I don't know, the Viagra Boys. It's basically just Adidas leisure wear.
That's pretty much...
Exactly.
And what about Mike? Tell me you thought he was a skinny black dude.
I thought he was like a video gamer with a lot of pimples.
I don't have that many pimples. Okay. So he's not too far off.
All right, man. That keeps our ego in check.
Now that we know how bad we look, what was your story involving money?
Okay, so really short story. So I used to be a heroin addict like 10 years back. I'm like 10 years sober now. And I was...
So you got fat.
I used to be fat, actually, yeah.
You're kidding me.
When you were on heroin?
You were a fat heroin addict?
Yeah, dude. You know how much candy heroin addicts eat?
I do not.
No, we don't.
Oh, my God.
Is that pretty universal for heroin addicts that candy is the go-to?
Ice cream, candy, 7-Eleven pizzas, you name it, you know?
All right.
But so I was trying to pick up one day, and my dealer wasn't picking up. So I called one of my buddies who I used to use with, and he was like, yeah, I got a guy, but just a heads up. We're about to go to his apartment. He's got, like, a bunch of computers everywhere. Like, don't ask any questions. This was back in, like, 2011. And we go there, and, yeah, sure enough, like, barely any furniture in the house, but he's got, like, a crap ton of computers everywhere. And we end up getting high with this guy, and he ends up bringing it up, and he goes, have you guys ever heard of Bitcoin? And obviously way back then, like, nobody knew what that was. So he's explaining it to us, whatever, and he's like, if you want, man, like, I have all these servers, and I do Bitcoin mining. Like, if you want to invest, like, if you want to give me, like, $500 or $1,000, I'll get you in on it. And I thought he was just trying to jack me. Nothing made sense at the time. I was like, no, I'm good. So I go home, and I asked one of my nerd buddies about it, and he's like, oh, yeah, like, I heard about it. I don't know necessarily if it's a good idea, but it sounds like he's got a cool operation over there. Maybe you should look into it. So long story short, I gave him, like $1,500, and Bitcoin at the time was under $300. I think it was, like, $200 or something like that. And I forgot about it because I was blasted for, like, the next 4 or 5 years. And when Bitcoin started kind of like coming back in the scene around like 2016, 2017, I was like, holy crap. I remember I bought a bunch. So I figured out my login, all of my like password phrases and all that stuff. I got into my wallet, and sure enough, there was like definitely like a little bit over $1 million in there. And I put like 1500, 2000 into it.
Did you cash out?
I did. Yeah.
Well, good for you.
You made $1 million.
Well, no, I cashed out half of it because I was so excited at the time. I was like, I'm just going to keep it for a little bit, but I did need some money. So I cashed out half of it, and I think I still have like 3 or 4 left. But that was just, I almost had a heart attack when I opened that account.
I would too, man. That's amazing.
Maybe you shouldn't be high on heroin again and make your investments.
Okay,
apparently, that's what works for you. Hey, by the way, Tim, just so you know, people are texting in after you gave your descriptions of what you pictured us looking like. Apparently, everyone agrees with you that they also thought that I was a big, fat, white dude. Someone says I thought the exact same thing about Thrill.
Yeah.
Someone else says, before I knew better, also thought Steve was a rotund white man similar to a 90s Rush Limbaugh. Somebody else says, Thrill from the Buzz days, I thought he was like Doc from the Love Boat, a chain smoker with a bad comb over. Jesus, man.
Man, you're sexy.
Is that what I sound like?
You are getting sexier by the moment.
Wow.
Well, speaking of $1 million.
I think you guys look good like how you are. When I Google you guys, I was like, oh, thank God he's not a fat white guy.
Okay.
So my wife says every night.
$1 million. Believe it or not, new survey comes out. It says most Americans think money can buy happiness. New survey on the subject even puts a number on it. Americans said they would need about $1.2 million to achieve happiness. Okay. According to the survey by a financial services firm called Empower. Figure breaks down in interesting ways. The people, depending on age groups, millennials need the most at nearly 1.7 million. Gen Z the least at just under 500,000.
Okay.
Boomers need about 1 million. And Gen Xers a bit over 1.2 million. In terms of gender, women would be happy with about 800,000 to 900,000. Men need about 1.5 million. Keep in mind that the most expensive country in the world to retire in is the United States of America.
Really?
That number is $775,000 that they say that you would need to have in the bank to comfortably retire at the age of retirement.
Sure, sure, sure.
But that is the most expensive in the world.
And that's at the age of retirement.
How much?
$750,000.
All right.
In Spain.
You're screwed, Ted.
In Spain, it's $375,000.
Yeah, let's go to Spain.
In Italy, it's $350,000. UK is about $438,000.
My God.
It's, it's crazy.
Ted, how much money do you think you lost out on with, was it Warby Parker, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because you had two buddies and what they started.
Oh, yeah.
Because you could have bought into it, and like anything.
Correct.
To be fair. You know, people pitch business ideas all the time. And if you had said we're going to do eyeglasses, what, through the internet or via the mail, I don't know that I would have bought into that either. But now they're doing brick and mortars. I see the commercials, and I'm like, oh, Ted.
You also have to have that money when you're that age. And most people don't have that kind of money.
Right, that was kind of the issue, right? Like, it was one of the guys who lived with the Hopkins, and he came for money. But he was like, hey, I'm starting this business. And he offered everybody we live with, like, you could buy in. But Burris and I at the time, you know, we're like 23 or whatever. Like, I didn't have $5,000 to my name, much less to spend on something.
Sure. Did anybody that you know, did any of your friends, did they contribute to that?
They did. I will say this. When I lived in that house at Hopkins, Burris and I were probably the only two that didn't come from means.
Right.
So other guys in the house were like, yeah, sure, no problem. And they made a
ton of money off it.
Ton of money, dude. Yeah.
My buddy Jeff did that. He invested with a guy that he worked with on a business venture that that guy was going off of. And basically, he had the idea, but Jeff had some more capital than he did.
All right.
So he put in half and half as the guy got bit by the tick and can't eat meat anymore.
Oh, okay. Right, right.
And he could, essentially, he could have retired 10 years ago. I don't know exactly what
the company.
It was some kind of chip thing that he tried to explain it to me, but it was more his partner's thing.
Sure.
Jeff just, it's kind of like the restaurant industry. Look, you might be the chef. You might have run restaurants. You might have all that hand in it, but you need capital.
You need cash.
You
right.
need money. So he was the money end of the deal, and he just trusted his buddy, and his buddy was successful.
Good. Well, yeah. That worked out. By the way, Ted, people are still checking on what they thought we looked like. Someone here said, I thought Ted was a crazy skinny white dude, like an amphetamine-fueled baseball coach.
It's an interesting description.
Yeah, I thought you'd be taller, thought you had to have hair. Saturday, some dude showed me a picture of his buddy, and he goes, you look just like my buddy. And I did. And then he came over 20 minutes later and was like, I didn't know you're Ted from the men's room. I said, yeah. And he goes, I thought you'd be a lot younger.
Oh, damn. Wow.
Jeez, man.
Thanks. I feel like I'm pretty honest, short, chubby dude. It is early 40s. Like, I don't know what else to say.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello.
Oh, hey, real quick, by the way, that guy that started Warby Parker, when he was done with that, he started Harry's.
Jesus Christ, are you kidding me?
Nope.
So he sold Warby Parker then?
He sold parts of it, and then, yeah, him and another group of friends started Harry's. And if you hear my voice, there's somebody's using Harry's.
Oh, without question. They're the monthly shave company, right?
Yeah, they have soaps in the store. They have a bunch of stuff.
Is he a multimillionaire now?
I'll be dead honest with you. We don't talk about it when we go on the trips because he's very generous, but we think he might be like that next echelon.
Yeah. You can tell when you go on a trip, when they do the casual, oh, dude, I got the bill. Like, we've been here for 6 hours drinking booze. Like, oh, dude, don't worry about me. I got it.
Damn. Good or bad?
I mean, you go to bars, and he will buy rounds of just trays of shots, and he just tells the bartenders, just send them out to the crowd. It's so much fun.
He is rich. If you should like, give it to everyone.
You should invite him to Seattle.
Yeah. Yeah,
why not? Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Devin. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
So my dad was really into climbing mountains. Back like in the late 80s and then early 90s. And it's kind of funny actually, because this story, there was really no money that was exchanged other than just a small deposit that he put down for his spot on the 1996 Everest expedition, which ended up turning into a disaster. I think every person died.
Jesus.
Well, a lot of people did.
Yeah, that In the Thin Air movie covers that one. So, yeah, I think he put down just a couple grand, and he had already been climbing with Rob Hall and Scott Fisher prior to that.
Damn.
In Alaska, he went down to Aconcagua and South America and other places. So
he probably knows that Visters too.
Well, my dad's not around anymore, so
okay.
Not sure, but I've gone to have boxes of letters and all kinds of stuff. I could look for that name, but yeah, it was pretty crazy. When the time came around, I think it was like 50 grand my dad had to come up with, and he just didn't have that kind of money. So wasn't able to go on the climb, and I don't know the time frame, but yeah, he found out pretty quick that wouldn't have been a good climb to go on.
No. Now, one of the guys that passed on who'd attempted that mountain a couple times, he was a local mailman in the area, and he obviously would train on mailbox every once in a while, but there was a shorty that he used to take every once in a while to train, and it's the cable line at Tiger Mountain.
All right.
So when Hair Club and I were training to get up on the Rainier, it's just a brute straight up. I mean, you're going straight up the mountain, but we trained on the same spot because that's where a lot of those guys
were
just to get a quick one in. But
I forgot you did Rainier.
I did not finish.
Almost.
I went for the views.
Are you going to ever try again?
And 100-mile-an-hour wind. Man, it just depends on my back. I've got really bad scoliosis, and I'm telling you, man, 60 pounds on my back really takes its toll.
Do you want to try it again?
Sure. I would love to go up there.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, the whole reason I went up there was I just wanted to see it. I just wanted to be on the mountain and look around. I've never been that high before on land.
But what about just like in the helicopters? Yeah, that's my thought. Like, man, this view is sick without all the climbing.
You know what's the weird thing about it is it's like there were probably four pilots in my group. Right. And I knew exactly why. They said, man, once you fly over this mountain a number of times,
you want to actually do it.
The bug just bites you. You're like, I want to step foot on that thing. I want to be at the top. I've flown around it enough. I've seen it nice days. Problem is, you see it on a nice day, then you go up there and it turns to crap. So that's what happened to basically us. I mean, we were in sideways crap, so it sucked. We were post-holing for what seemed like forever.
Everything you've described about that particular climb sounds absolutely dreadful to me.
But then you get a bean burrito, you know, at night.
I get a bean burrito.
A bunch of guys just fart all together.
Stop bragging.
Right, exactly.
I know.
Boy, that was fun for the money. Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Terry. Welcome to the men's room.
Liquor and whores.
Liquor and whores.
All right, have I got a story for you.
All right.
My husband broke his leg really, really bad and had to have surgery the next day. After his surgery and he was able to go home, the surgeon told him that he had to stay off of his leg for about 6 to 7 months for it to heal good, or it would re-break and it would be worse than when he did it before.
Jesus.
So he could not work. He does drywall. He could not work for all during that time. So we got behind on our mortgage. And we was within a week of having it foreclosed on. And I run a lost and found pet site. All of my members got together and paid the money that we were back on, that we were late on.
Wow,
$14,000.
Get out of here. Was that like a GoFundMe thing that you put together?
No, I didn't do it. One of my members that knows me and knew of our situation just put a post up on my site, and every one of those members started donating. Okay. Anywhere from $1 to $1,000.
Now, let me ask you, with your business, the dogs don't just run out of their house and come to yours.
Are you stealing them and then
something? So how does this work? Do you just take in animals that show up at shelters that you can't find an owner for?
It's not a business. It's just volunteer. I have a site, and whenever a dog goes missing, somebody will post it on there. Or if they find one, somebody will post it on there.
That's very cool.
I will go out and along with other people and search for these dogs and cats, whatever.
What's your trick? Pocket full of pepperoni?
No, well, it's good to have something if you find one.
Sure.
But I have found a lot of animals. So have a lot of other people on my group. But I honestly don't know why they all did that. They said that I deserved it, you know. But
It sounds to me like you're helping a lot of people. They just want to help you back.
Yeah, I mean, you do something decent. It's shocking. Sometimes you get paid back in kind in a time of need anyway. Mm-hmm. But that is spectacular.
How's your husband now? Is he back to work and feeling better?
Yep. Everything's fine now.
Are you glad to have him back out of the house?
Oh yes! Oh God, yes!
does he bring Dustin all the time? And like, if I pull that guy over, your husband, like, and I'm a state trooper, you know, I'd be like, dude, how much cocaine's in your car?
Right,
like your whole face. Like, what are you doing here, man? Come on, get it together.
Yep.
How long have you been doing? How long have you been doing the animal lost and found site?
I've had it for probably 6 years, maybe.
Okay.
Something like that.
What is the longest amount of time that's gone by between the loss of an animal and then it being, brought back home?
On my site that I know of, probably about a year.
Okay. What's the longest distance traveled, either even by car by somebody else or whatever the deal was?
From here to Texas.
Damn.
Now, was the animal taken, I guess, in a vehicle to Texas, relocated, or put in a shelter?
Yeah, it was relocated. They took it. Somebody found it, didn't try to find the owner, just kept it, and they moved to Texas. And somehow, that dog got loose again after they had moved and went to the shelter, and it was chipped. Of course, microchip. Everybody do it. It saves animals.
Yep.
They called the people and they were like, you've got to be kidding. We were all shocked. I couldn't believe it. They couldn't believe it whenever they got home. I went over and saw the dog. You know, I mean, it was amazing.
How did they drive down to get their dog? Is that what they did?
Yep. You sure?
I would.
Did the dog have a draw?
Rough. Yeah. Exactly. Barbecue.
And by the way, Terry, are you located in Pierce County?
Yes, I am.
You're getting a lot of love on our text line. A lot of people say, Terry down here in Pierce County. That was the Tacoma, Pierce County, lost and found pets. Yay. She saved her dogs and cats, very much into it. Bless this woman. Apparently, you're quite popular.
Yay. Good for you.
Thank you so much. I am truly, truly blessed with the members that I've got.
Yeah, well, you're doing God's work there.
Yeah, man. Know? Reading this text line, I can see why they donated to you.
Good
that
or bad?
Dog only drank Dr. Pepper.
Put the Dr. Pepper in my water bowl.
Rough.
Yeah. Came back with a burnt orange raincoat.
Right.
Yeah, right.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fix 5. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention Love20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
Dealing with an accident and injury claim can be overwhelming. Let Phillips Law Firm fight for you. We understand the pain and suffering, and we're here to guide you through. Call 1-800-JUSTICE today for a free case review or visit justiceforyou.com and let Phillips Law Firm help you on the road to recovery.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing, but I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fix 5. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
99.9 KISW. We return to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
So the story goes, when Richard Pryor died, it left a hole in Eddie Murphy's wallet. A $100,000 hole.
And he could use the money.
So, Eddie Murphy released an album of music called How Could It Be in 1985. And you said, well, I knew Eddie had a couple of tunes, and he did.
Was that the one with Put It In Your Mouth?
He had Boogie In Your Butt, which we have as interior decorating.
In the butt.
And he also had Party All The Time. Now, those were two songs that were written, I believe, and produced by Rick James.
Yes.
But they were at the end of Eddie Murphy Raw. So, he did the actual comedy album. And then at the end of the album, there were a couple tunes on there.
All right.
So, what Richard Pryor said was this. Eddie said, look, I'm going to release an entire album of music. And when he told that to Richard Pryor, Richard said there was no way that Eddie could make an entire album with just music and no comedy. That was impossible. He bet Eddie $100,000 that it would not happen. So when Eddie did release the album, he wrote this inside of the liner notes. This one's for Richard Pryor, my idol, with whom I have a $100,000 bet. No, mother effer, I didn't forget. Pryor died in 2005, and apparently he never paid up on the bet. Now, Eddie Murphy doesn't have the worst voice in the world. What I did not know until a couple days ago was that Richard Pryor, when he started out, not only was he doing comedy, but he was also a singer. He was a...
For real?
A big-time singer. Like,
seriously.
He was on television a lot. He performed in front of, I want to say he sang at the Apollo. The guy was...
Richard Pryor.
Richard Pryor.
No idea.
And Mike, you found some Richard Pryor singing, didn't you?
I did indeed.
It sounds like Richard Pryor, but he's singing.
This is a recording all the way from 1966.
When you're down.
I had no idea, man.
If anybody should have released a musical album, maybe Richard Pryor. Our question, good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Raymond. Welcome to the men's room.
Quack, quack, bicholas.
Hola.
I heard a boo in there. Well, anyways, back in early 2000s, my mom had passed away, and I got a big chunk of money, like about $35,000, $40,000. So it all got blown on either I bought three vehicles and the rest was on drugs and alcohol.
How fast was the money gone?
It was a week and a half.
A week and a half? You bought three vehicles at one time?
At different days, at different places. I'd be going around. I'd say, hey, I like that. Let's go check that out. And then I'd end up walking out with it.
What did you end up buying?
Let's see. I ended up with a 98 Chevy Suburban.
Okay.
And then an 84 Dodge Ram Charger that was on 44-inch tires and built. And then a 74 Jeep pickup.
Damn. So you bought a classic then, too.
Yeah.
And what kind of drugs were you doing? I'm guessing cocaine if you blew that much cash that quick.
Well, I'm the guy that always calls and talks from Klamath Falls, so it was meth.
Oh, it was meth. Okay, all right.
Of course it was. Yeah.
Now, what happened to those cars? Did you sell them eventually or what? To try to get some money back?
Yeah, after I wrecked them pretty much. I was pretty rough on my cars when I was younger. So,
did you have any siblings?
I did. They're all older than me.
Did they make responsible decisions with their money? Not saying that you didn't, but did they make...
But you didn't.
You had fun, but did they like buy a house or anything like that?
Two of them did.
Okay.
And the rest, we all just did what we wanted.
I'm sure your mom knew when the money was distributed.
You know who your kids are.
Exactly what's going to happen with that money.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's why the two that did the right things, they got more money than the other three.
I was going to ask.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, your mom knows.
But hey, in the end, you still got 35 grand in vehicles, meth, and booze.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like a pretty good bender. Oh.
Absolutely. I didn't bother me a bit. I knew, like you said, my mother knew me and knew what I was going to spend it on.
I was going to say, do you have any regrets about where you spent the money when you look back?
No, not at that age. I had a good time.
Good.
I cannot imagine having that kind of money when I'm younger. That's a small amount of money compared to what a professional athlete makes. But you can understand bad decision making with a 22-year-old who's now a multimillionaire. At that age, I would have absolutely crashed and burned.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. And you know, we get older and you'll get on athletes about certain things. But I'm like, man, let's be honest. And if I'm honest about myself, if in my 20s I signed a 7-figure, 8-figure contract, I guarantee I would not have lasted more than one season, mm-hmm. whatever sport I'm playing.
Yep.
Like, man, I'd have been doing blow,
hooker. No, trust me.
I'd have been in the news a lot.
We when Steve and I went back to Baltimore for the Seahawks and the Ravens game, the Ravens honored a former player out on the field before the game. It just so happened that we both had separate conversations about this guy with different parties before going into the game.
Because they didn't know who this guy was. So Miles is sitting in one place with a group of people. I'm sitting in a different place with a group of people.
But this is before I knew he was going to be honored.
Yeah, I had no idea
he was going to be on the field.
But they brought this guy out, and then to explain to the people around us who this guy was, because we know who he is, but to explain who he was, we basically said the position he played, and then we both told the exact same story about this dude.
I can't remember the number. It's like 60-some million dollars that he made in his professional career. And I know for a fact either he now lives home with his mother,
mm-hmm.
or he lives with his brother or sister.
I mean, he's broke, man.
That money's gone.
And it wasn't hard to tell, though. I mean, some of the stuff he had, you're just like, that's not cost efficient.
Do you remember his Ford F-750?
That's what I'm referencing.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, you've never seen a truck this big in your life. And you don't need it.
You can't park it anywhere.
But this is the same guy who, rolled up, so we could give tickets to hookers or what was
strippers.
This deal?
Strippers.
The strippers. Yeah. Strippers. That's
he dropped them. Okay, so kickoff time is 1:05.
Yeah, something like that.
1:10 East Coast time. And we are in a parking lot, and we're having a tailgate, and the tailgate is a catty corner directly across from the stadium. He rolls up, rolls down the window, hands two tickets to White Leon.
Yeah.
And basically says, you know who these are for, or whatever the deal is. So Leon, of course, comes up and tells us who the tickets are for, rolls up the window, and drives the stadium. We are an hour before kickoff.
Yeah, he's just getting there.
He's just getting there. This is 12:10, 12:15. Like, oh my God, dude, you barely have time to get taped. You know, I think. And he walked out on the phone. He played that game.
He had a good game, too.
Yeah. It was just,
man, tickets for strippers.
Mm-hmm. But did not show up to the facility until an hour before kickoff. Less than an hour before kickoff.
I get the feeling he had been with them earlier in the day.
Probably. Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Pete. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, smoked ribs and homebrew.
Hola.
Hey. Yeah, I called you guys once before and my phone dropped and I was the guy that saved everybody from getting COVID because I got super drunk. I don't know if you remember that last year.
Nice.
I don't, but I like the story
save
already.
The day.
Yeah. Anyway, a couple years ago, we got the last kid out of the house off to school and we bought a house. Been working on that a lot. Been working on my girlfriend's family's place, helping take care of the kids. And, you know, my girlfriend was saying, you're making weird noises at night, man. Think about it. And, you know, I was just missing motorcycling, but I was trying to be a good parent. And my sister was going through my mom's effects and found a savings account I hadn't touched in 45 years. So I got a hold of the bank that bought the bank that bought the savings and loan, and they said the state had the money. A bunch of paperwork later, I see the numbers, and, you know, my girlfriend says, you've been making motorcycle sounds in your sleep. You should go buy a bike. So I went and bought a Harley with it.
Okay. So it was enough money. It was over $20,000 then.
It wasn't that good, but you never ask a woman her age, you never ask a farmer his acreage, and you don't ask me about money.
That's probably good rules to live by, man.
Exactly. Well, you're saving a lot of money now that your kids are gone, right?
Yeah. We put up with the house in Bellevue for a long time because it's a great school district, but once we got last one off to a full-ride scholarship at Western, we sold that nightmare. And
they got a full-ride scholarship?
Dude, that's $100,000, man. Easy. Even in state. Yeah, even in state.
He's a good... Yeah, and so, I mean, it's Western. It's not Stanford, but what the heck?
Right.
It's cool.
But it's a free run. Hey. Brother, I don't care if it's community college. Like, dude, go. If you can do that.
If I had the means to an end and I could have done it back in the day, which I did not, I would have at least tried to finance a small apartment or a condo or something for my children compared to what I spent for them living in a place for 4 years.
Right.
If I had the money to be able to put a down payment
on
the place
cheaper.
And just own the place and then either rent it or sell it when she was done, I would have done that in a heartbeat, but I just didn't have the capital to do it.
Pete, how many kids do you have?
Well, I got one, and she's 16 and wants to vomit at the sound of my voice. And then my girlfriend's got three twin boys. And,
oh, my God.
Oh, man, tell me about that. Driving them to school when they were 13 in my little tiny truck, man, it smelled like elk and rut.
that's a scent you don't buy at Nordstrom.
I remember talking to my dad about butting heads with these 16-year-old boys, and he says, well, have they been brought home by the police at 2:30 in the morning? I'm like, no, but that was more like a lift home than an arrest. But your point is made and taken.
Yes.
He says, well, have you had to go talk to the principal about getting into fights? I'm like, no, I would actually understand that. I could work with that. And have you had to talk to a very angry father about a pregnant daughter?
Oh.
Like, how many sons do you have? That one wasn't me. And he was like, I'm just trying to make sure you're listening.
Okay.
I like your style, man.
Exactly. I like your dad's style. Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello. I like his second rule. Never ask a farmer about his acreage.
I've never heard that one before, but I'm like, all right, fair enough. So next time I meet a farmer, I'll be sure I don't ask.
Now I know why his kids smell like elk and rut.
As we're at the bar, and Ted, you'll appreciate this, at the local watering hole, as it were, a couple guys were in there during the daytime, and they were bringing up the Ravens playing something, and I'm like, oh, actually, my brother just officiated that game. And they're like, unbelievable. So you go with the whole explanation. Yeah, he's a referee. But that's actually his part-time gig. He has a regular job. So they said, if you don't mind my asking, how much money does he make? And to be honest with you, I don't know, but I'm guessing probably around $750 to $1 million a year between the two gigs. I don't know, but he has no kids. You know what I mean? So he's doing well. But I said, I don't know, fellas, but I do know this. He has to work two jobs to make ends meet.
Yes, right.
That's all I'm saying. And I reminded that my, I say it every time, man. My parents are here last week, and they're saying something about him. I'm like, yeah, but he's got to work two jobs. I'm just saying.
Right.
You know, the youngest son, I just have one.
I work smart.
Well. Yeah, I work smarter, not harder. Hello, Taylor. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, bitches.
Hola.
So, first time, long time. And, Ted, this is Taylor that saw your family at the beer garden back in July. So, LARP.
Oh, nice.
Basically, my whole story is had an ex-wife that I found out was later diagnosed with bipolar personality disorder. And
had you already kind of pre-diagnosed that yourself?
She was kind of cool at the start, and then like put the ring on, and then S hit the fan.
Okay, put the ring on.
Was it really that fast that that happened?
We were together for 5 years total, married for two, and after the first year, it was like, you knew.
Okay.
I was taking an EMT course, planning on going into that for medical school, give them all my hours. And then come home one day, and there's 12 boxes of deliveries at our house, and check the savings account for my financial aid, and it is at zero.
Oh, my God.
From your financial aid.
Yep. Was not working at the time, so school full-time, and, yeah, about $3,500 just gone.
Oh, my God.
A lot of it was clothing that she cut the tags off and everything, so couldn't return anything.
Jesus, dude. So when you confront her about this, how does it go down?
A lot of yelling.
Yeah, I would think so. Mm-hmm.
And then shortly after that was when filed for divorce. And the kicker of it all is got some really bad lawyers and missed out on about $30,000-ish on a home sale.
Damn, man. So what do you do now? Did you manage to get back to EMT school or no?
Reapplying to it. By the time I paid off the school for what I owed them, I hit the year timeline, so I couldn't take the exam for the national certification.
Right.
But within the next, month or two, I'm going to be retaking another class and going for firefighting.
What was your wife at that time's explanation for why she spent all your money?
Oh, well, there was money in the account, and she needed things.
Okay.
Yeah. I got the feeling that would be the general, because we had money. And I wanted this. So I took that money and I bought this.
There are people, we just talked to a caller the other day. Said, if there's money in the bank, I'm spending it.
What the hell were we talking about?
I don't know. But I just thought to myself, man, I would love to be able to do that. But my conscience is, I still feel like I need to, just in case, a little bit of a,
backup. I was so broke for so long, I never, quote unquote, had money in the bank. Like, you literally were just making ends meet. You know, the money went in the bank, but then you're going to pay your rent or whatever little piddly-ass groceries you get. I mean, this is at a point, and this is post-homeless, right? But even after that, not to say radio doesn't pay well, but it doesn't. So I just gotten into radio, and at that point, I had that damn cat that my ex-girlfriend just had to have, and then when we break up, she's like, well, the cat's yours now. I'm like, how does that work? But I realized I got to feed the damn cat, and I got to eat myself. So basically, once a day, it was a can of Starkist tuna. I take this plastic knife, give the cat half, gave myself half. And that was it. I mean, but that's all the money I had. Mm-hmm. Then you start making some money, and I can start saving money. And I'm honest to God, like, I don't really think about it. Like, just leave it alone.
Yep.
Just leave it in the account. You know what I mean? I got a roof over my head. I'm good, man. I just want money for vinyl. That's pretty much it. It's the only thing I have to argue with my wife about.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Matt. Welcome to the men's room.
How you doing today?
Hola. Hola. Doing great, sir. It's Positive
Hola
Friday.
Happy Positive Friday. Positive.
Thank you.
Positive Friday, my brother.
It's a Positive Friday. Yes, so my story is I was born in Mount Vernon, Washington. All my aunts, uncles, both grandparents, everything up there. And my uncle was in the early 80s. He used to move furniture as a furniture mover and would go to the bar every afternoon. And a guy told him, there is a small coffee shop in Seattle that is going public, and I think you should invest money into it. And he looked it up. He put $8,000 into the very first day of the New York Stock Exchange for Starbucks.
Oh, man.
And he has made so much. He's bought in two houses off of that. It doubled, it tripled.
It split.
That was the best thing that he ever did in his life, he said.
Yeah, well, no, yeah. Unless you invested in Google or Microsoft, yeah, investing in Starbucks at the start, probably the best financial decision you've made.
Yeah.
You want to talk about crazy money. Miles and I are at the bar. There's this older guy sitting next to us, real nice dude, and he's just chatting with us about whatever. Well, what brings you to Seattle? And he goes, well, actually, I'm on my way with like Spokane or something like that to meet with my brother-in-law. I'm retired now, and I do some consulting, basically. Well, what do you do? He goes, well, I had a decent amount of money, but I retired, and then my brother-in-law convinced me to invest in a product that I thought was stupid, but, you know, whatever, I gave him the money. And now, basically, I'm a multimillionaire, right? Nothing about it. So what did you invest in? So when you go to Starbucks, they're the main buyers of these.
Oh, yeah.
Anytime you get a hot coffee drink with the lid on it, and they stick that little plastic thing in there so your coffee doesn't spill, that's what his brother-in-law came
with. The cap on top.
And I'm like, that's what it is. He goes, bro, he said, I thought it was stupid when he suggested it, but I threw him the cash. He goes, the Starbucks basically got into a contract with him. We are worth millions of dollars. And as a shock to no one, the cost of producing a thin piece of plastic is almost nil, right? I mean, I was just like, oh, my God, that's how you're a millionaire.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fixed Fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault? Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention Love20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
Deep underground, the Jelly Belly Factory, BB is in her secret laboratory creating the weird and wild flavors of Bean Boozled.
I've done it again!
Is it pomegranate or old bandage? Dare to compare. Bean Boozled, 6th edition. Are you brave enough?
99.9 KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Coming up, we'll drink and toast in the weekend with a shot of the day. Then it's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Choice Friday.
You know it's
Bad Choice Friday.
Hey, man,
this is your fault.
Jam on. And we celebrate the Pac-12 championship on a Bad Choice Friday with Weird Al Yankovic.
A new duck. One that won't try to bite. One that won't chew a hole in my socks. One that won't quack all night. I want a new duck.
Weird Al wants a new duck. On a Bad Choice Friday. Take it on the Baja, man.
You think they're blaming the who? That they're answering their own question?
Could be. Yeah.
I just never thought about
like
that until now.
Seuss, maybe.
Yeah.
Weird Al Yankovic, I want a new duck. Take it on the Baja Men. And who let the dogs out? One of those two tunes. I will play right after the shot of the day. Vote now if you follow us on Twitter at Men's Room Live. Our question, good or bad, what is your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Brandon. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Liquors and whores.
Liquor and whores.
So,
My story is kind of similar to the last guy about Bitcoin, except for without the heroin and copious amounts of alcohol in college. So I had a similar buddy who was a real good techie, and he told all of us in college, he said, yeah, Bitcoin's the next thing. And he had been mining off from this school's energy. So he had like four or five systems just rolling at all times. And he gave a bunch of us about 2,000 each Bitcoin. I can't remember if it was 2009 or 2010. And I wasn't thinking of anything of it. I didn't really know anything about it. And I'd asked one of my finance friends, I said, what do you think about it? And he said, nah, you know, it's crap. And he was big into stocks. And he just told me to forget about it. And so I put it in an email. I put my passphrase in an email from high school. And about 2016, I was like, oh my God, I have so much Bitcoin. And my wife got really excited, and they deleted my account.
They deleted your account?
Yeah, I didn't use the email for 5 years, and they deleted the account.
You've got to be. How much money do you think you would have been entitled to?
I mean, 2,000 times what was it back then? About 30,000.
Wow.
At its max in 2016.
That seems like a, I don't know, man. Like, I guess it's not FDIC insured, but
it is not.
That seems like a very strange thing to keep up with. I know that Amazon, or I'm sorry, was it Google that deleted a lot of accounts, I believe, starting...
It was Google, yeah.
Starting today, based on the fact that...
Mine will be gone.
If you didn't log in, or you never, you know, used your email, or whatever the account is...
I never used it, I read that last week, and I'm like, cool, they're about to get rid of it. It just... Right, I never used it.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
I've known people that had Bitcoin early on, and like any stock, just kind of cashed it out, because they wanted to get something, and then are like, man, I should have held on to it.
But, you know, but like anything, it's hard to know. I know one person personally, and it's another tech guy who got involved in the Bitcoin thing and trying to explain it to me. He did pretty well. He cashed out. He got a feeling that it was about to start tanking.
Okay.
You know, you're kind of keeping up with just the whispers out there and everything. So he pulled his money out. He probably made like 800 grand, man. Damn. Like, he did real nice. Well. Yeah, for him. Like, he's telling me this. And like, you're happy for your friends, but also... Part of you is just so irritated. You know what I mean? Like, didn't I just buy the last round of drinks? I just bought these, and now you're telling me you made $800,000. Come on, man.
It's a lot of coin.
Yes, it is. Hello, Todd. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, boys.
Hola.
All righty. So I'm going back on the story of the gal that did the pet rescue, or the lost and found on the pets.
Yeah.
That almost lost her house. You know, and everybody chipped in to help her save her house.
Yeah, I remember that call, yeah.
Yeah, it was been a minute ago. But it was springtime, and my wife and I, she was into horses, which is great, and I was into real stuff, fishing. Anyways, her and her sister-in-law were in a big club, a horse club, and they got the horses out, and they were trying to get them ready for all the spring gaming, because they did barrel racing, pole bending, all kinds of anything to do the horses. What's that?
Said all kinds of horsing around.
Hell.
No, come on. No, she never did that. Anyways, so it was a Sunday, and my sister-in-law came in, and she said, call 911. I said, what's going on? Shannon's hurt. So I called 911. This is before cell phones. It's been a long time ago. I called 911. The ambulance came. She got hurt real bad, really bad. And ended up taking a helicopter ride to Spokane out of Newport, Washington. And they said, I went to the hospital. They said she's basically stretched a nerve in her neck. So it's like she had a stroke. Her whole left side was paralyzed.
Damn.
Her left arm, her left leg, her whole left leg was paralyzed. She was paralyzed. And so I went in the next morning and I talked to my boss. I said, Shannon's hurt and I got to take a few days off. And they said, take all the time you need. This is part of the family part. The guys I work with, the people I work with, the company I work with, take all the time you need. So I took a week off, came in the next Monday because I had to go back to work to pay the bills.
Of course.
And I showed up at work. She was still in the hospital, not out of ICU. And she said, what are you doing here? I said, I got to pay my bills. And my boss comes up to me, hands me a check or an envelope. And I opened it in the break room from all the guys. I almost started crying. Opened it up, looked at it, $1,800.
Damn. Wow. So your coworkers pulled together.
My coworkers pulled together, raised $900. And the owner of the sawmill doubled it. He paid whatever anybody would pay, he doubled it. If they gave me $900, he gave me $900.
Did you have medical insurance at the time?
Yes.
Okay, what was that helicopter ride? Not that you paid for the full amount, but how much did that cost as far as the coverage on the insurance?
I do not know, because at the time we had really good insurance, 90%
Damn.
Covered.
Okay, that is really good.
I paid 10% of whatever, you know, hospital, helicopter, ambulance, everything in between.
Yeah, well, $200,000 is still $20,000. And if you don't have $20,000, it's wonderful. That's why you pay for insurance.
Yeah,
but it still doesn't mean you're not going to pay.
Yeah, inevitably, you got to pay something. But, man, they get you on everything. I remember when I broke my ankle, I'm like 11 or 12 years old. I'm a kid. And it's sledding accident because I'm a badass like that. But I get home. My
parents, nice.
Yeah, Ted, you know, dog.
I know, brother, I know.
So my ride or die. So I get home. My parents are not home, but my brother is. And I'm like, man, I don't know. I just messed up my ankle. He said it might be broken, whatever. So his advice, my brother's advice to me, said, look, until our parents get home, just prop your foot up, put ice on it. That's what I did. My parents get home. We explain the situation. They take me to the emergency room. Yes, your ankle's broken. Blah, 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 blah. The doctor says, hey, well, one of the things you can do when you get back home, keep your foot elevated and put ice on it, which is what I've been doing, suggesting my brother. Anyway, we get the bill, and I just hear my father cussing under his breath. I'm like, what's up? And he's like, I'm not bitching about the bill itself, but he shows me everything's itemized. Mm-hmm. It was 100, and this is like 1982. So obviously the price of everything's gone through the roof, but advice. That was one of the things that they had with $175 for advice. And the advice was the advice I got for free from my brother, which was elevate your ankle and put ice on it. My dad's like, we have to pay them $175 goddamn dollars for you to do the obvious just because he said to do the obvious. But my brother's there. He's like, well, you should pay me $175 because I said it first.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Brad. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey.
Hola. Hola. Yes, we can hear you.
Hey, you are. Hey, quick, how you say this? You guys like a quick riddle?
Sure. What's your quick riddle?
All right. If there was an award to the best teacher on the planet, what would it be? Most people agree experience. Would you agree with that? Best teacher on the planet?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so who would the award go to the best student?
That is a fine riddle. I don't know who.
The one who can learn from somebody else's experience. Here's my story. So Brother Dan has a buddy who borrowed $20 years ago. Never saw that 20 or that buddy again. I see you pissed off. He goes, not at all. He says, if I can figure out my friends for only $20, that's a good investment. That's clever.
I like that.
20 years later, I got a buddy of mine I've known since I was 14 years old. We come up with a deal to buy a piece of equipment off him for about $23,000. So I muscle enough cash together. The only deal was no paperwork. But he thought no paperwork, and I thought no paperwork were two different programs. So into the machine for a couple of years, had a little mishap doing some snow removal. And the guy... And I tell him, well, I can get insurance on this. My buddy says, well, we said no paperwork. No paperwork. It's not registered in my name. Tell my buddy, I says, well, here's the problem. I can get insurance, but if I don't get insurance and there's an incident, they're going to track it back to you. And this guy I've known, like I say, since I was 14 years old, so a 30-year relationship, he says, no, I'll just report it stolen. So in a sense, my good buddy just called me a thief after that many years. That's my story. So if you're making a deal... Never do it without paperwork. That would just be foolish.
I would agree with that.
Yeah. I mean, if I'm spending $23,000, yeah, I want paperwork.
On something that needs to be registered.
Unless I'm buying $23,000 worth of drugs. But yes, if I'm going to buy a vehicle or machine for $23,000. But thank you for the sound advice.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Yeah, about this house. You got a deed? No paperwork, man. Just gave him the cash. It's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, it's obviously going to be stolen already or something. That doesn't make sense.
When you don't want paperwork, that leads me to believe that, yes, I just bought something that I should not have. Hello, Jesse. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
All right. This probably happened 06, 07. Okay? It's a Saturday night. I go up to the Muckleshoot Casino with my wife. The place is packed. We walk over to this Caribbean stud poker game. And I see that the progressive, it's like it was over $600,000.
Damn.
Now, I had won 10 grand on this game in like 2000, I think, 2001. And so I'm like, hey, I'm going to play this game. There's one spot left open on the table, but I choose not to sit down because there was an extremely large individual sitting at the table. And everyone was crowded, and I mean, she was taking up like a third of the table space. The other people were playing standing up because she's taking up so much space. So I'm like, you know what? I asked my wife, she's hungry. She's like, yeah, I'm hungry. So I go, let's go grab a bite to eat. So we go sit in the restaurant. About 20 minutes go by. All this screaming starts happening. And I just looked at my wife and gave her the look. And I just knew. I just had a gut-wrenching feeling that it hit. So I run over there, and sure enough, the spot that I would have played, that person shimmied in there, was playing, got a royal flush dealt to them, and they won the progressive jackpot.
You said like 600 grand?
$600,000. Wow. It was enough money to, you know, you can make some moves at that point. You know what I mean?
I would have puked.
Yes. Yes, you can.
It took me a long time to get over that, and I actually cried on the way home. No joke.
I believe you, man. That's, oh, my God.
Good times. Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
I would seriously throw up.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Just a... Hello, Jason. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Okay, so bad story turned into good. 97, I was 13, got hit by a boat when we were going to the sea fair and got pretty messed up.
Hello.
And the Cairo 7 covered it. And because of the news coverage of interviewing us, there was people from Alaska, from Idaho, Montana, the Midwest that were sending us money to help out with medical bills and pay for everything while our lawsuit was going through.
How bad were you messed up? What was the damage to you?
Double busted pelvis. I had a giant S laceration from my groin to my shoulder.
Was that from the boat or the prop?
It was from the prop hitting me.
Okay.
It didn't tear me open. It was enough to just make me bleed. Tore a bunch of skin off my shoulder. I had a massive enclosed head injury. My dad messed up his broken neck from like 20 years ago because of the incident. I entered the hospital in grave condition, and I didn't even get my operation or pulled out of the ICU for 3 days because they told my dad that he needed to start making preparations.
Yeah, because the next step from grave is dead. You go from critical, which is bad, to grave, and then you are dead, right?
Do you remember any of this?
I remember all of it. It was a half hour after midnight, the day of the main race of the Sea Fair, August 10th, 1997. I was excited. I couldn't sleep. And I was just sitting up on the boat where the dining table folds down into a bed. And I heard a boat coming, and I coun't see where it was coming from because they didn't have any of their bow lights or running lights on. And they came straight through the back of our boat, and I took the bow in the forehead. And then when the boat hit us, it went airborne and landed back down on top of us.
Jesus.
And that's when it snapped my pelvis. And as it was rolling off the boat, the prop scored my chest.
So you got hit by a prop on a motor, and the motor wasn't even in the water?
It was on top of our boat.
I know.
The reason it didn't cut me as bad is because it killed their motor, so the prop was winding down.
Ah, okay.
Well, we had full canvas on the boat, and when their boat finally rolled off of ours, it rolled our boat capsized. I got wrapped up in the canvas and went down with the boat.
Jesus Christ, man.
We were right outside the atrium in the UW.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that deep. So my dad dove down, was able to rip the canvas off me and keep me back up. And the guys, the only reason those guys stopped is because one of their buddies was voiding his battles off the swim step. And when they hit us, it launched him over the whole accident. And they were going to take off, but they couldn't find their buddy. So he was in the water yelling, "We got to help these people. We hit somebody." So he actually took the initiative to help get us on the boat. And he was refusing to get on until we got on the boat.
Did you guys win a lawsuit in that?
We did.
Okay. And how much money did you get in donations before all that kicked in?
Just to take care of the bills while we were, before my dad went to work fairly quickly. It was like a month after the accident before he got back to work, light duty. But I mean, people were sending us checks for $1,000, $150, $250 just to help for groceries and pay for
that's cool
power bill and everything.
How are you now?
It's really amazing.
I mean,
I'm 40.
I know, but would you ever know that you are any,
if you take your
any
shirt
scars
off
or anything like that?
What was that?
I said, do you have any scars from this? I mean, is there any, if I met you, would I know that you got run over by a boat on top of a boat?
You could hear my pelvis popping sometimes when I'm walking. I have two steel pins that span my pelvis to hold it together. They literally had to bolt me back together.
God almighty, man.
And then I've got four incision scars where they had to do the operation. I mean, 27 years later, I've still got four scars, but they're only about an inch and a half wide.
Not the worst.
They went. One of them went through my pubic bone to my left butt cheek, and then the other one went from my left hip bone to my right hip bone. So I've got two full span bolts in my pelvis.
Was there any of the settlement money left for you when you turned 18?
So what happened was we went through a year and a half of litigation with it, and then we ended up settling out of court, which was our best option after talking with everybody. But my dad didn't want me to blow through it, and he wasn't the best with money. So he appointed a guardian ad litem to handle my financial end of the lawsuit.
Okay.
So what happened was they put it into an annuity for me. So they amortized my payments from, my first payment was 18, and then it went from 18 to 25. And the guardian ad litem was actually able to get State Farm, which is the insurance company that we were suing, to pay us out and have them reinvest the money back into their company and give me 2.5 points higher interest rate than anybody out there. So I over doubled my money in 7 years of investment on that annuity.
Nice.
Wow.
Well, okay. You know what? Good for you, because you had to deal with it from a physical standpoint. So
yeah, easier ways to make money.
Yeah, I would say that. That's a fact.
Yeah, I'm dealing with it today. Every winter, I can feel it. It feels like somebody's putting their knee in the back of my hip and grabbing me by the balls of my hip and trying to roll me backwards because those pins get cold and it hurts.
Damn, man. That is like one of the worst stories that ever, as far as you get hit by, you take the barrel in the forehead, then the boat goes airborne, then you get cut by the prop into thinking that should be the end of the story. Then you get dragged down to the bottom of Lake frickin' Washington because you're wrapped up in the canvas. My God, man.
Good or bad, what's your best story involving money? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Lisa. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
Okay, so this one is on the positive side, not like that last story.
Yeah, that was not the most uplifting story.
Glad you're still here.
No. So one day, it's in the evening, my husband and I are in two different cars, and he is in a rental car, kind of a gutless rental car, and we're both getting ready to merge onto the freeway. So it's one of those roundabout on ramps type thing. Mm-hmm. So he's in his car, I'm in mine, this Mercedes comes up and kind of cuts him off. And I see that all of a sudden I look and it looks like there's somebody in the back seat fighting with someone else. It's like they are actually in a brawl in the backseat of this Mercedes. At this point, they just cut my husband off, so I'm a little bit concerned because he's got Mr. Anger Management, so I'm already concerned about that. And so at the same time, I'm watching this, and this back door of the car kind of opens up a little bit. All of a sudden, you see somebody's half of their butt cheek kind of hanging out because they're fighting so bad. And then all of a sudden, I see this. I didn't know what it was, but it was like a... the only way I can make the noise. I don't know if it comes over on the radio correct or not, but this something came out. And I started to merge onto the freeway. My husband is ahead of me now, and I'm thinking he's probably in an I-5 argument. And I stopped the car. All of a sudden, I thought, hey, that was money that just came out of that guy's pocket that got his butt that got swung out from the door. I'm like, wait a minute. I back the car up all the way around. I get out of the car. I am running across two lanes of traffic, picking up bills after bills after bills. I didn't know. I saw some 20s. I saw a couple hundreds. I just thought, okay, I'm just going to keep going here. I don't care if my husband's upset. Can't control that. All I can control is this money. So I'm picking it up. At one point, this car kind of pulls up to see what's going on, thinking there might be a problem. And then all that, you can kind of tell that they decided maybe they shouldn't get involved since I was a crazy woman running all over the place. And then the next thing you know, I had to go back to the car at one point and unload the money and then go back out across two lanes of traffic in between cars driving by to pick up more. I get in the car. I start heading on the on-ramp because as I'm picking up this money, I'm thinking, okay, well, if this is, you know, anything but drug money, they're going to be coming back around after they get off the next exit. So I have got to get out of here and fast. I don't even know if the person in the car knew that they even lost the money.
How much did you end up collecting there?
Over $1,300.
Oh, yeah. Good little Frogger. Risking your life. But...
yeah, that's drug money,
man.
Yes, you're carrying that much cash in your pocket. Yeah. You are buying drugs.
Lick the bills and stab 2 hours later. Oh. Coming up, the exciting return of Ted versus the FCC and your emails on the way next in the men's room at KISW.com.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fix 5. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fix 5. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Coming up, we'll drink and toast of the weekend with a shot of the day that is Bad Choice Friday time.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Choice Friday.
Hey
man, this is your fault.
Come on. And today we celebrate the Pac-12 championship on a Bad Choice Friday with Weird Al Yankovic.
I want a new duck, one that won't try to bite, one that won't chew a hole in my socks, one that won't quack all night.
Damn ducks.
I want a new duck, one with big web feet, one that knows how to wash my car and keep his room real neat.
Weird Al Yankovic and I Want a New Duck taking on the Baja Men on a Bad Choice Friday.
Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out?
The irony in putting these two songs against each other. Obviously, the Baja Men representing UW on this one.
Mm-hmm.
And I Want a New Duck representing Oregon. Is the fact that if you care enough to vote on this, you probably won't be listening for the winner because the game already began.
Yeah, that is a strong point.
But either way, we encourage you to vote now if you follow us on Twitter at Men's Room Live, because one of those two tunes coming up right after we drink and toast with the shot of the day. All right, so let's see here. Ted versus the FCC is coming up, but first time for a few emails from the Men's Room at KISW.com.
You've got mail.
And a couple from our question, good or bad, what's your best story involving money? Ola, back when I was in college at Washington State, I was supposed to be paying everything from federal grants. But the grants, they were taking forever to come in. So I kept waiting, calling, and putting everything on my credit card that I couldn't afford at the time, thinking the situation would eventually resolve itself. Finally, I went into one of the financial aid hubs and talked to them. They told me that I'd already received the money. I was dumbfounded. They brought out the paperwork, and I looked at the signature. It was a beautiful, cursive, artistic signature. My signature is a hot mess. I told them, that's not my signature. They said, prove it. And I filled out a page with my chicken scratch signature. They started the ball in getting my money and no longer thought that I was lying. Positive Fridays, guys. That's from Terry. I'm a broke bitch. But the first time I ever bought a scratch ticket in my life, I won $1,000. It was a Seahawks scratch ticket, which made it even better. Rock on, guys. That's from Iris, the bus driver.
Iris.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Iris, with the name, like, you were born to drive buses. The name Iris.
Very well, probably.
Right? It sounds like the name of a bus driver.
Okay.
These damn kids. Yeah. They always bitch when I light my Pall Mall with the windows up.
And
I can't even smoke in the bus anymore, Montgomery.
That meth, cigarettes, you name it.
You can't on the way home, but someone would rat you out.
I know.
That's a problem. You could have an empty bus. Like, I just saw a bus driver smoking. Oh, come on.
There's no seatbelts in here. Who cares about the smoke?
They won't even let me freebase, for Christ's sake.
It smells like 35 years of children peeing and throwing up in it. Ola Naked Ladies, today is my niece, goddaughter, Bethy's seventh lap around the flaming ball in the sky.
Bethy!
Could the little gremlin here get a little kid fish sandwich, some Mike bitter batter, and some dad jokes for Miles? We love you, Squirt. Thank you guys for the laughs to keep me sane in the world that's getting insane, and happy 4,000. That from Godfather Rainier and Aunt Kate.
Fish sandwich!
Betty bought her about some butter, but she said it's butter bitter. If I put it in my batter, make my batter bitter. So she bought a bitter, bitter butter, put it in her bitter batter, made her bitter, batter, better. So just better Betty bought her about a bitter, batter, butter.
All right, 7 years old. I got some jokes. Dad joke Friday. What do rabbits use after showering?
What do rabbits use after showering? I don't know. What do rabbits use after showering?
A hair dryer.
All right.
Yep. What does a tick have in common with the Eiffel Tower? Again, what does a tick have in common with the Eiffel Tower?
What does a tick have in common with the Eiffel Tower?
They're both Paris sites.
Okay. All right.
Why do ghosts always get invited to parties?
Why do ghosts always get invited to parties?
Yeah.
I don't know.
They bring all the booze?
They always bring the booze. Ted is correct. And did you know that the first French fries in the world were not actually cooked in France?
No. Where were they cooked?
They were cooked in Greece.
Hey-o. You're so proud of yourself.
All of you ladies, today is my... Oh, I already did that one. Ola, could you please give a shout-out and wish my son Adam a very happy 32nd birthday? He is a sweet, loving, and fun guy. And I'm very proud of all he has accomplished and very blessed to be his mom. If you guys could give him an owl hitting the window, a couple of thrill shotgun gets, and one of the fart sounds. Because for some reason, boys of all ages, they just think farts are funny.
Because they are.
Thank you so much, guys. That from Julie. Dick. Dick. Hey guys, happy birthday!
God, that's a nasty fart right there.
Happy birthday to the T-Town Gravedigger, the best dad, partner, workaholic, and jack-of-all-trades in the world, and we don't always tell him how much we appreciate him. So please talk all over each other about what he could do with me tonight while I'm on pain pills. And it's a time to take off the leash would be good, too. Thanks for keeping us laughing. That from the lovely Michelle.
It's time to take off the leash!
Well, you're on pain pills. So basically, I would take the one round that normally you don't want to go.
One time, you just don't want to do it. Hey, tonight, look.
The long road.
Just let me have this moment.
If you're on the pain pills,
the
difference is you might get pooped on.
But this way, there's a good chance, man. It might be great.
It might be awfully messy as well. All right, guys, here you go.
Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday to you, to you, to you.
Yaws a Dirty German is brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Mmm, Schweinefleisch.
Thank you, Bob. And a couple extra emails here, guys. Ola, I have a suggestion for you all.
All right.
An archival channel on the Odyssey app that features nothing but old celebrity interviews that you guys have conducted.
Mm-hmm.
I'll call it something like the Men's Room, A Moment with the Stars or something. Clips are self-contained since Miles always introduces who you're going to talk to. So all you need to do as far as the app is label it with the star's name and when the interview was originally broadcast. I bet there's a lot of good interviews in the past that are no longer available to listen to on the daily podcast section. People would be intrigued just by seeing the name of some of the celebrities listed in a list of interviews in A Moment with the Channel with the Stars. Something to consider, that from Ryan in Port Orchard, who says cheers. Ryan, I just don't think we have them.
You know what? Mike actually did his due diligence, and we talked about it earlier today, a little thing we do at 1 o'clock called Nothing in Particular. We read that very email, and I was like, dude, I honestly don't remember half of who we interviewed. Mike's like... And there's a huge list of people, but what's funny is some of them, like, I don't remember interviewing this person. Mike's like, you did. And then there were like two or three people. I'm like, who is this? Like, I don't know.
Like, for who? For an example.
I'd have to grab the list. Hold on.
Grab it.
All right.
Or do you have it? Okay.
I mean, yeah. You can go get the list, but
I normally forget that we've interviewed someone. Ted's great at this, but I'm terrible. If they die or something. Not decent in the news happens, I remember. If good things come in the news, I remember that.
Sure.
But other than that, I'm kind of like, oh, yeah, that was fun.
One of the ones that he forgot that you guys had interviewed was Alice Cooper. I had the story where I had to hang up on Alice Cooper, but he doesn't even remember actually interviewing the guy.
I really don't.
No.
I remember you having to hang up on him, but I do not remember
actually
talking to him.
So here's a partial list. Andrew W.K.
Remember that. Crazy dude. A lot of fun.
He was awesome, and his show that night was great.
Brian Posehn.
All right.
Oh, yeah. You'd recognize him.
Sure.
I know who he is. I don't remember talking to him.
Yeah, he's a balding guy.
Yeah.
Very funny. Redheaded dude. Chelsea Peretti.
Yeah, I remember that.
What was her big show, Ted? Chelsea's? Didn't she, like, after...
Wasn't she on Brooklyn?
I mean, she was Brooklyn Nine-Nine. She's been in a bunch of stuff.
Eugene Mirman. Now, he does Bob's Burgers,
right? He plays Gene. Okay.
All right. Everlast.
I remember that. He was a cool dude in the studio.
Very cool.
I asked him around.
John Keister from Almost Live.
Yeah, remember that.
And Ted, you actually went on that show when they did the reboot.
Correct. I like that guy.
Let's see here. Kim Thiel from Soundgarden.
Yep.
Neil Brennan, who does now, like, what, AT&T commercials, stand-up comedian, used to be the head writer for the Chappelle Show.
I remember him. Do not remember interviewing him.
Okay. Pablo Francisco.
It was awesome. You should remember it.
The one, Neil
Brennan?
Neil Brennan?
Yeah. Neil Brennan was great.
What, the talk about the bidet?
We talked about that. We talked about like the something with him, like meeting Obama. He just had great stories.
Yep. Pablo Francisco.
I remember that.
Comedian has been around for a while. Let's see here. What else? Rising West, Sam Loeffler. Serge Tankian, the lead singer of System of a Down.
He was cool.
Shined Down multiple times.
That got us in trouble.
Why do we always get in trouble with him?
Because he kept using the acronym for the name of his band.
Oh, God, right, yeah.
Ben and I went to the show that last night, and he's like, I'm Serge Tankian, and here's the blah, blah, blah. And we were like, oh, I did not know that's what that meant.
Yeah, the flying seas of something.
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
Shinedown / Steel Panther multiple times, Tom Green multiple times, Todd Glass, Ben Shepherd, the bassist from Soundgarden, John Moffat. Ex-Seahawk. He was the guy who played guard for a while. Went to University of Wisconsin.
And remember, with Shepard, it was kind of awkward because he just doesn't do a lot of interviews. And then Jolene drove him back to the venue, and he was like, oh, that was great. And we were like, really? Like,
I said that to Mike earlier. So we interviewed he's notoriously grumpy, right? And when he was here,
he's a big guy, so you're afraid he's going to beat his ass, which, you know.
And I don't know if he's serious, but he sounds serious, kind of grumpy. Yeah, we thought he hated us. And Jolene's like, no, dude, it said it was a great time.
Barrett Martin from Screaming Trees.
Yep.
He's a cool dude.
Mad Season.
He is a uniquely cool dude.
Christopher Titus, comedian. Used to have a television show on Fox. Brody Stevens, late Brody Stevens from Seattle, who passed on. Mark Maron, Dana White, Joe Perry, Sig Hansen, Vince Neil.
Joe Perry sucked.
Hailstorm, Chester Bennington, the Sonics, the classic Seattle a band from back in the late 60s, early 70s. Ari Spears, Alice Cooper, Bo Phillips, who was a program director here for years, Ron Halford from Judas Priest.
That was cool.
AC/DC, John Witherspoon, who has since passed on.
Since passed on, yeah.
Brad Evans, America's Sweetheart, as you would say, Ted. Ice-T, Sarah Colonna, Demetrius Johnson, the Mighty Mouse.
Yeah. You were super attracted
maybe to... Maybe pound for pound, the greatest fighter in the history of the sport, right?
Ted, you'll probably back me up on this one. Sarah Colonna was here. Miles was smitten.
I like Sarah Colonna.
I know you do. Yeah. I did not realize how much she likes it.
She likes punters.
Yeah.
Right. She likes punters. She enjoys a beverage and she's attractive. So I mean, it's like a Miles Trap.
The perfect storm. Yeah,
it's the bartender. It's the bartender you like. You know,
dude, Miles. I sat in her seats after the Seahawks got rid of John Ryan. His buddy Greg was like, "Yeah, I have their old seats. You would have loved them. Like first two on the row." And I was like, "Cause he's like, well, she likes to drink. See, it's easy access to the bathroom."
Tyler Connolly from Theory of a Dead Man. Chris Cornell. Ty Pozzebon. Who I believe he's a tough one. He's passed on. Josh Wolf, Gilbert Gottfried, Kenny Mayne, Casey Keller, Perry Farrell. Oh God, Brian Dickinson, Misha Tate.
Oh yeah,
whoa, that woman.
Yes. Oh, that was. Yes,
we cannot put into words how beautiful.
Please
she is
kick
a
my ass.
She looks great on
kick
screen.
My ass.
She looks great in photographs. Oh, that woman radiates
God
when she walks into the room.
Jesus, all of us are like, oh my! But you're scared to even act like you find interest in her for fear that she'd beat
Robert,
you to death.
Robert Dugoni, local author. Cool. William Duvall, lead singer of Alice in Chains, David Draymond from Disturbed, Radke, Issa Akira, who told us a lot of things about losing stuff in crazy places, Chris Novoselic from Nirvana, who else? David LaBrava, who was one of the coolest guys in the world.
He was cool.
He was intense.
You thought he could kill you, but he's really
intense,
just a nice guy.
But he is a good guy.
Lars Ulrich, Jerry Cantrell, sticks it in.
David LaBrava, you got to remember, like he's on the Sons of Anarchy, but he's actually a member of a certain, they hired him as a consultant
because he knows the life, and then they gave him a role.
Sticks it in ya.
Yeah.
Aaron Jones, Chad Kroger from Nickelback, Rob Thomas, Matchbox 20, Sean Kemp, your Sonics.
Miles, or Mike
Ricky
and I,
Williams, whether you're a Dolphin or a Saint fan, you know.
Mike and I were saying earlier that Rob Thomas is probably just the coolest guy. We like that.
Probably the most natural fit when it came to this show.
Oh, yeah. He just comes in and
bust Ted's balls the whole time. Time to go back in time. Speaking of, to the last time that we played Ted versus the FCC. So if we could, let's go back in time.
Helen Hunt is a cunning huntress. Helen Hunt cuts her hunts. Cunning hunting, cutting hunts. Hunt is cunning, hunting cuts.
Three times fast.
Helen Hunt is a cunning huntress. Helen Hunt cuts her hunts. Cunning hunting, cutting hunts. Hunt is cunning hunting cuts.
One.
Helen Hunt is a cunning huntress. Helen Hunt cuts her hunts. Cunning hunting, cutting hunts. Hunt is cunning, hunting cuts.
Two.
Helen Hunt is a cunning huntress. Helen Hunt cuts her hunts. Cunning hunting, cutting hunts. Hunt is cunning, hunting cuts.
Oh, my God.
It took a couple tries to get that one, but we finally got a win in Ted versus the FCC. Let's do it again.
And now, everyone's favorite daytime game show, where one person could lose $325,000 at their job or win and walk away with nothing. Yeah. It's time for Ted versus the FCC.
Oh, yeah, Ted, I know you're not going to go out tonight because you're sick at home, but we stayed up so late last time. I'm not even sure I want to go out on a Friday night. You know,
so late.
There's nothing on television. I'm just, what a late night. So we came up with some tongue twisters for you, buddy, but unfortunately, we got a listener submitted Ted versus the FCC. It's not unfortunate. As we say, the listener always comes first. And the email says, hola, guys. Listening for a while, and I paid attention to the submissions that give Ted the most trouble. Ted, on his own admission, has stated before that S-words give him the most trouble.
Why'd you say it out loud, Ted?
I do not expect Ted to win. On the contrary, I guarantee a mark on the loss column.
They guarantee this.
Best of luck and LARP on, Ted. Best regards. That from Maxwell Turner III, Esquire. And he just sent that one in, as you can see, Steve.
Right, oh, my God, that is real new.
And your Ted versus the FCC goes something like this.
Not 8 years old or anything.
No. The shifty city ship sits in the shifty city ship sitter. If the shifty city ship sitter won't sit, the shifty city must ship the shifty city ship a new shifty city ship sitter. The way we play Ted versus the FCC is you have to read that one time through, then three times fast.
Oh, no, I don't have it.
You don't have it in your email?
No, something must have happened. No, I have it.
Okay. I was like, did I forget to send that?
I don't have the benefit of being able to see if you say it clearly, Ted. So if you could, please just say it as clearly as possible.
Okay, Mike.
Thank you, sir.
The shifty city ship sits in the shifty city ship sitter. If the shifty city ship sitter won't sit, the shifty city must ship the shifty city ship with a new shifty city ship sitter.
Three times fast.
The swifty city ship sits in the swifty city ship sitter. If the swifty city ship sitter won't sit, the Swifty City must ship the Swifty City ship to a new Swifty City ship sitter.
One.
The Shifty City ship sits to the Shifty City ship sitter. If the Shifty City ship sitter won't sit, the Shifty City must ship the Shifty City ship to a new Shifty City ship sitter.
Two.
The Shifty City ship sits in the Shifty City ship sitter, then the Shifty City ship sitter won't sit. The Shifty City must ship the Swifty City ship to a new Swifty City ship sitter.
Whoa. Wow. Unbelievable.
That was crazy. A big win from home in Ted versus the FCC. You are listening to the Men's Room.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fix 5. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault? Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention Love20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
Deep underground, the Jelly Belly Factory. BB is in her secret laboratory creating the weird and wild flavors of Bean Boozled.
I've done it again!
Is it pomegranate or old bandage? Dare to compare. Bean Boozled, 6th edition. Are you brave enough?
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Coming up on this Post-So Positive Friday, we'll drink and toast the weekend with a shot of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check out with Mike Hogg and some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
Thank you, Miles. 32% of Americans are confident that they could land a plane in an emergency.
Sweet.
And survive?
I'm not confident. I don't think there's an option. You got to give it a chance.
And that's kind of where I'm at with you, Miles. It's like, no, I'm probably going to kill us all. But I know for sure we're going to die if nobody grabs this wheel.
Here's my thought on this. You know for a fact I will give it my best effort because I don't want to die either.
Correct.
But we're going to.
We are going to die. But there's a 1%
a
chance.
Or something, maybe we can do this. But if you're talking like on a 747.
We're all screwed.
You're going to die.
Right.
You know, this is your temporary captain speaking. Listen, I swear to God I'm going to do my best to land this, but let's face it, we're going to die. We're going to die.
I'm not
going to
lie, dude.
Die.
But your last act before you die is being able to crack the thing.
This is your acting captain speaking.
I just wanted to do this before I die. And since that's going to happen in about 2 minutes, gotta give it a try. Let's get that beverage cart working.
Start
no charge.
Them
out. No charge.
No charge. Yeah, no charge. Age limit.
Drink on the house. Drink. Saying, you know what? You too, kid.
Also, here you go. Also, drink fast.
Oh, God. Yeah. I'm going to give this thing about 2 minutes and you we're going to nosedive this.
As they
bitch.
Say, you need to finish that, sir.
Oh, God. A relationship expert says referring to your partner as mommy or daddy in front of your kids is having a negative impact on your sex life.
Doing that in front of anyone.
Okay.
Bothers me.
I thought the same thing, but then I just was like, it's kind of an asinine, weird thing to say, but I thought about it. It's like, no. I think it is when you are talking to your kid and saying, take this to daddy, take this to mommy. I think that's part of it. Oh. I think that's the problem.
I don't do the E. We say mom or dad. Like, dude, ask your mom.
Yeah.
I don't call her mom, but if they're asking me something that I don't feel like dealing with, I do the, dude, just ask your mom. And 90% of the time, the response is, she told me to ask you. Like, damn it.
Son of a gun.
All right.
Now,
my grandparents called each other mother and father.
That is a very big thing
with
for that
your
age.
Grandfather, Mike Pence.
Right.
He was not.
Mother. Like, ew, man. Come on.
That was
is
a
that
thing
the
for
sexiest pet name you could come up
I
with?
I don't
mother?
Know why they do that, man, but that is a thing with that generation because my grandparents did it too.
Really?
Yes.
God, that's so. I just feel like, ew, man. I don't even call my mother mother.
And at what point does it change from the person's name into mother?
Once you have kids.
I guess.
But even then, like I said, I might say, ask your mother. I never say, ask mother.
Ask mother.
Right. I get the creeps, dude. That is, to me, that's psycho stuff.
Oh, mother.
Oh, mother. You're so, like, ew, man.
Yeah. 82% of people are open to receiving used holiday gifts.
Well, I mean, it depends what it is.
Yeah, that's all. Here, these look like they're your size. They really spiced up our bedroom.
Do you ever think you just got a brand new fresh partner? Used.
Damn, Miles.
Come on.
No.
Every person you're with is used.
Doggone it. Yeah, to a degree.
I mean, it's like a car. Like, I've never bought a new car.
Gently used.
Not even gently. Driven like a maniac.
Or sometimes somebody just gets you a gift that's like not for you. So it's like, I'll just re-gift it to somebody that wants it.
Right, and you know who those people are. Like, I don't like this, but I know who.
Like the Native American frog you have, Ted.
Well, hey, that thing worked great at the White Elephant.
Yes.
How did that? I was that. We bought this stupid looking ceramic thing, right? It's kind of like a frog sitting on its ass, and then it had like a black mohawk, if I remember correctly.
And like a shield and a spear, I think.
Yeah, but dressed in
Native American. Yeah.
It was like the label was Native American. Well, it was Native American frog without Native American.
Was he from Cleveland, Miles?
Yes, he was.
And you said that thing killed.
Right. And then last year, I bought the matching one.
No, I did. I bought it for you. I brought it back up.
Well, you bought me the first one, right? Then I got the second one last year. People were like, holy S, you got another one? I was like,
there's a whole set.
Oh, my God.
I mean, look, they don't call the name of that store Treasures for nothing.
That's a fact. That is a fact. Gentlemen, as we're moving into the holiday season, we know that temperatures are going to rise, tensions are going to be high, and sometimes people are going to say things that are just honestly rude, and sometimes we find ourselves a little bit speechless in that point. But luckily, I have a few things to help you out. VD,
the men's room top 10, the men's room top 10,
the best 10 comeback phrases to remember when someone is rude to you. Here's a couple I appreciate. Hey dude, I can fix my looks any day, but how will you fix your stupidity? Or, I want to slap you right now, but I don't want to make your face look better. And my personal favorite from the great philosopher George Costanza. Well, the jerk store called and they're running out of you. Sick burn. <Yeah.
laughs> So these are the 10 best comeback phrases to remember when someone is rude. Do you see if this would help quell the conversation here? I think we should end this conversation now.
All right, not the worst. Typically, by the time someone says that, you're probably in agreement.
Yeah. Typically.
Well, depending on where you are in a situation like that, like, let's stop this.
Right, let's just end this conversation before it even gets to that point, right?
I've been on the other side where it's been so bad. It's like, let's just end this conversation now. We can talk about it later or another time.
My wife and I do that a lot now. My big thing is, right, starting to get heated. Because with couples, it's always ticky-tacky.
Sure.
Stupid. So the good way I found to end it, like, are we going to divorce court over this? And typically, answer, no. Like, let's let it go.
Right.
This is not worth our time.
I like the, I'm at work. Can we talk about this when I'm not here trying to do my job?
Trying to get into a headspace here?
Yeah. Like, we have time to talk about it. It's not pertinent. We can get there.
Kind of in the same realm, can we talk about this later? So it's kind of the same vein of, I think we should end this conversation now. Much like what Ted's saying, can we talk about this later? Can we just move on?
Sometimes, yeah. And Miles is right. Whether you're at work or out to dinner or something, sometimes you're just like that. Like, I can't have this conversation with you right now.
Right.
You don't play football on a baseball field.
That is correct. That is correct.
But you can.
One of my favorites. I'm sorry you feel that way.
Well, people feel how they feel.
I tend to say that a lot, which is a way of saying, like, look, I disagree. Before it gets an argument, all I can tell you is this. I'm not going to change my position. And clearly, you're not going to change yours either. But I am sorry you feel that way. That's sincere. But we need to let it go.
Well, Ryan Castle's got the best one. I'm sorry this is happening to you.
Sorry that happened to you.
Yeah, but I do think saying I'm sorry you feel that way is kind of like, screw it.
Right. It means
it definitely is.
It does, yeah.
But it sounds better than me just saying screw it. So
it does show zero remorse on your part for saying, I'm sorry you feel that way. I'm standing firm on where I'm at, but I'm sorry that you feel that way. Let's see here. Let's continue this discussion when we're both calm.
That's fair.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that's fair. Because I mean, like, if it's that important to you and you've gotten to the point where it's starting to just get Barbie, you go like, This is important to us. We will get back to this, but let's not just start insulting each other.
Correct.
Right?
Right, because we're not getting anywhere at this point.
We're not talking about the issue. We're just mad at each other.
Now we're just spitting at each other.
Best comeback phrases to remember when someone is rude to you: I won't tolerate disrespect.
Oh, shut up.
Well, you have to earn that.
I agree with that. If you're a disrespectful person, right.
Like, you have to be disrespectful a lot.
Exactly.
You've earned that. I'm kidding. No, you have to earn respect.
Right. I'm sorry, you do have to earn disrespect, too.
You have to earn respect. But there's also a way to talk to people, and some people have a certain, like, people can talk, like, you don't have to respect me, but you also aren't going to disrespect me. Yes. Talk down to me.
Yeah, correct. That's fair. Yeah. Like, do not condescend to me.
Right.
I absolutely end conversations with that, which has happened fairly recently. I just don't speak to this person. And I'm not mean to them. I'm just like, you don't exist in my orbit.
Exactly.
Right? That's where you chose to be, and that's
problem
okay.
Problem is, we work together.
I'm about to say, is that...
Look, I will talk to you from 2 to 6.
That's it.
We are co-workers.
Draw the line.
And then we're done.
Remember, behind his back thrill.
Hey, I don't mind talking about Miles behind his back, but he always gets pissed off when he hears what we really think of him.
I got scoliosis, Dan. I'm curved, so it just bounces off me like Teflon.
It rolls over the top.
Like a turtle.
Behind your back and over your head.
Like a turtle.
Can't hear anything with that sweater wrapped around his neck.
That's right.
It's one thing I have in common with George Santos. Lots of cardigan sweaters.
Oh, yeah.
And black rim glasses.
And Botox.
And Botox.
This conversation is becoming unproductive. And I'm going back to the list here. I'm not talking about what we're talking about here.
Okay, I had to ask.
This conversation is becoming unproductive.
I feel like that's a line that Hair Club would drop on us.
That's a meeting line, yes.
That's what I'm saying. It's very work-oriented.
Okay, this conversation is becoming unproductive. And
it's almost like you've met Hair Club. You've just nailed it.
I'm sorry you feel that way.
Right. I think he probably says all of those things.
Let's continue this discussion when we're both calm.
Right. I mean, out of this is say things that Hair Club has said to you in any given meeting.
The three-tier takedown.
Yeah.
The three-tier takedown.
Love that, brother.
You look great. Great job on this.
No, you don't look good. You look like ass.
You look stupid.
Who picked out that shirt? What the hell are you doing? Are those your shoes that you're wearing to work? And then, by the way, you did a great job yesterday, by the way, Mike, on headlines. Now let's get to the real point of why I want to drive you in the ground.
Right. It's not unproductive. I just never said that.
The old three-tier takedown.
Let's see. I understand that you're upset. That sounds condescending, too.
It does. Like, you obviously know I'm upset. I'm expressing.
Right. I came to you saying I'm upset.
Yeah, it's like saying, I recognize water's wet. Yeah, because it's wet.
You're not reading the room there.
I recognize, and again, I say it in the one voice I hear with all of these, I recognize that you're upset.
Right.
Again, this is all Hair Club. I mean, honest to God. I'm not even making fun of him. Like, these are exactly the types of things
Understand that he has to have these conversations because you get upset, blow up on the air, and then he has to pull you into his office to where then you explain why you're upset and why you blew up on the air. Okay, I understand that you're upset, but I won't tolerate disrespect.
Yeah. I don't think I ever disrespected him, at least not in a way he can tell.
Yeah, he couldn't tell your disrespect. Oh, jeez. Okay. These are the best 10 comeback phrases to remember when someone is rude to you. Castle has a different way of saying this, but I appreciate your feedback.
Yes.
His one that he taught me a while back is, thank you for the words.
Thank you for the words.
I can't really say that.
But Castle does, man. That's very much.
Oh, God. VD's running out of the studio.
I've got a great Castle one that he tells every now and then. When he was standing outside of a Mariners game having a cigarette, and somebody came up to him and said, hey, you know, you shouldn't be smoking. It's bad for your health. And his response immediately was, you shouldn't talk to strangers. It's very dangerous.
I would say you shouldn't talk to serial killers.
I remember him telling me that. I was just like, that's a good line.
Neither. Very bad for my health. Mm-hmm. Neither is angering and an aggressive person.
God told me, I stepped outside the airport. A cop came up to me and goes, you can't smoke here. I'm like, oh, smoking is illegal in West Virginia. It's like, you know, you can't smoke here. I was like, also 15 feet. He's like, yeah. I'm like, good for you, man. Good for you.
Way to go.
You did it.
Hey, way to
Way to crack down on it.
Thanks, man.
I hear every time we land in SeaTac, because they changed it. It used to be if you went to the end of baggage claim, that was a smoking area.
Ah.
They've now moved to, like, up an escalator, blah, blah, blah. And SeaTac, if you're listening.
Because the bus load an area.
Don't care. I always go to that same door and I smoke. And I've had one security guard that goes, oh, hey, man, I'm not trying to be this guy. You can't smoke here. I was like, oh, I'm sorry, bro, man. I didn't know. Then he goes, are you thrilled? I go, yeah. He's like, well, BS, man. I said, look, man, just let me cheat half of this. He's
get
like,
your go ahead.
I got my defense is I've been on a plane in an airport for 14 hours.
Yeah.
This is my first cigarette. Will you just please give me a break? I'm not near anyone. I'm outside.
You know what the other trick is? If you go out through one of the arrival doors when you get the baggage claim, light up your cigarette, and when you're smoking, keep walking because every sign says no smoking.
Yeah.
So you act like, oh, damn. And I realize by the time I walk the length of the airport and get around, I have smoked a cigarette.
I'm sorry. But then the number one comeback phrase to remember when someone is rude to you and it actually is endearing to the other person. Thank you for your perspective.
Back to Hair Club again. I swear to God.
Thank you for your perspective. we're going to go.
I kind of like that one I've used when somebody has said something really rude to me. I go, well, thank you for saying that.
I remember Ted's line used to be, anytime if you made a good counterpoint. No. Like, you'd be talking and you would say something to Ted, and if you made a good counterpoint, Ted would always point at you and say, thanks for being on The Factor. You've just crushed what I'm saying. You've embarrassed me. Go away now. Thank you for being on The Factor.
Oh, God. Authorities in Florida stopped a thief attempting to catch them all, Miles.
What was he trying to catch there, Mike?
Give you all the details at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50. In the meantime,
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo stove, fixed fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo stove, fixed fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
What was he trying to catch there, Mike?
Give you all the details at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50. In the meantime, have we made it to the weekend in drinking time?
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And The Men's Room knows just who it is. So
to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Drink time it is. As usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve at Thrill Hill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today we toast Arnaldo Chamorro. Now, I probably don't need to tell you this because I'm sure you all know that he's the chief of staff for Paraguay's agricultural ministry. Well, he recently decided to resign. It seems that earlier in October, he signed a proclamation with a country, the United States of KISW. Basically, it is sort of an agreement with another country to exchange ideas, exchange cultural things, help them with agricultural things, etc., etc. The United States of KISW reached out to him. He responded back, and Paraguay entered into a partnership. Shouldn't be a big deal. But he ended up resigning when everyone found out later, the United States of KISW does not exist. It is not a freaking country. But this guy signed an official memorandum of understanding with this place. And they were like, dude, that is so stupid. You have to go. Understand, the United States of KISW would be the equivalent of you calling yourself a sovereign citizen. Welcome to the city of Mike. Right? There is no business to be done with you. There's no.
So yeah, this place, welcome to the city of Mike.
And the thing is, it was created. It does not exist. There is no physical location. It was created by a guy who's wanted in India for sex abuse and everything else. But he's trying to do the sovereign citizen thing. They're still looking for him. They don't know who this guy is. And this dumbass is just like, you know what? Absolutely. We support it. So, yeah, they asked him to step down. And he agreed that maybe if I don't know countries on this planet and my job is to deal with other countries on this planet, I shouldn't be here. Just saying. So we pour this booze and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy!
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies.
Down the hola, bitola!
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
It's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Hey, man, this is your fault.
Jam on. And today we celebrate the Pac-12 championship on a Bad Choice Friday. Echo, echo. Weird Al Yankovic, and I want a new duck taking on the Baja Men. And who let the dogs out, Mike?
How was the voting?
It wasn't even close at all, Miles. It was a 70-30 split. And being more of a WSU guy myself, I don't have a dog in this fight, as it were. Hell. However, I have taken up arms with my fellow Washingtonians because I can't stand to have Oregon win. And at this Bad Choice Friday, you are going to bow down to your Bad Choice Friday winner, Baja Men.
Yes, absolutely. What? Welcome to the weekend. You're listening to Men's Room 99.9 KISW Seattle.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo stove, fixed fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Now for all TV news all the time, it's time for TV Time with Ted.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the men's room presents TV Time with Ted.
Ah!
There's that delay.
Oh, was I too late? No, I'm there, right?
No, I mean, it's like a half-second delay.
Hello.
You know, it's just one of those things. What are you going to do?
All right. Let's see. Where am I going to start here? The problem is I got everything digital now, so I'm clicking around. I'm like, am I still plugged in? It's also, I got to explain, you have no idea. Miles, you did it last year. It's so weird doing the show from just sitting at my table.
I like the masturbation aspect of it.
That's why I don't do it on Zoom anymore, Miles.
How much time we got there between the break? Okay, cool.
I did not do that, but full disclosure, when the show started, I just taken a shower. It's just in my boxers when I did my...
click, clack. Click, clack.
Thank you so much for not sharing that in the moment.
I mean, hell, if you want, I can get buck naked right now.
You know what? Do TV time naked. Yeah. Naked TV time.
Go out there and pet your cats that are hanging out by your slider.
Go dogs. Let's go.
Naked.
Go dogs. There's a bear in that
one. Hey, Ted, do you still have those cats hanging out behind your house?
I do. And every day my mom asked me about them. And I said, hey, they just hang out.
Like, so you still haven't bridged the gap on making friends with these cats?
No. If I go outside, they're super nice. They rub up on me. They say hello.
Do they? They definitely like you.
They're going to break you down, man. You're gonna, next thing you know, you're going to have them in your house.
Cat Ted.
Exactly. That,
I swear to God, I have to tell like my mom and other people when they're visiting, like, close the screen door. Like, that cat, those cats are waiting to get in here.
Yes, they are.
And if they get in, they're not leaving.
On your couch now. Now sleeping with you.
All right, here's kind of a wild one. Full House, the cast of Full House, the original one, needed some FBI protection.
What?
From what?
Yeah, I guess John Stamos was on a podcast with Julie Sweetney and Andrea Barber. They were, when I say she was one of the daughters, I think Andrea was one of the friends that lived next door, Kimmy. I guess some psycho shows up outside the studio where they're being filmed saying he was going to kill John Stamos.
Jesus.
Someone calls security. Dude's gone before they showed up. So John Stamos had an FBI agent following him around for 24 hours a day. I like Stamos goes, I was so stupid because I tried to ditch him.
Well, I mean, of course you did. What else are you going to do? Who wants to kill John Stamos?
I don't know. And here's the thing is that I'm always happy that I think everybody I know is a normal person. But you forget, there's just whack jobs out there, man.
Sure. I do remember Ted reading a story about the Bush daughters. And they had constant detail, right? But they like to throw down. So they would end up figuring out a way to kind of either rub off in a weird way, like money-wise, or like, look, I'm going to be here till 2 o'clock in the morning. You can be outside of the building, but I'm going to be in there doing my thing with my boyfriend. Like, you can't come up and stand in the hallway. Like,
okay.
So they were trying to like sneak out of clubs and try to figure out a way to get away from the detail when they were out doing their stuff that 20-year-old people do.
Yeah, I mean, it's got to be kind of strange to be a teenager just trying to do normal teenage stuff. Correct. When you have a secret security detail.
It's hard enough to keep it away from your parents, but now you've got someone over your ear.
I would think like that would be the worst thing. You know, you'd be proud of either one of your parents. They're the president of the United States of America. Man, oh man, right? There is no higher office. There's nothing you can do more than that. But I'm a kid. I'm a teen. I'm trying to sneak smokes, man. I'm trying to get laid. I want to do some drugs.
I want to smoke weed.
And there's social security, Jesus. A secret service literally around the corner all the time.
So, like, in D.C., right, there's go-go music. So a lot of the high schools will have go-gos at their high school that are, you know, ideally a little bit safer for high school kids to go to. Excuse me. So Sidwell Friends would have them, but Chelsea Clinton was going there at the time. So if she showed up, you could tell, and, like, half the people wouldn't go because they couldn't sneak in booze.
Right,
you can't do months or whatever, because now the security's real tight.
Dude, years ago, cooking at a specific restaurant, and it was, Gorbachev was the then president or prime minister, whatever, of Russia. So it wasn't him, but his wife was in town, and was it Tipper Gore or, I can't remember. Either way, it was either, what's her name? What's Clinton's name? The chick, his wife.
Chelsea?
Oh, not Chelsea's mom. It was either Hillary or, I don't remember, but they were there with the mayor and something else for some whatever. So we knew they were coming in because obviously they don't just surprise you with this. We knew like 2 weeks in advance. But Secret Service, they come by and they said, look, if you're going to work this day based on the people we're going to have in your restaurant, and keep in mind, no one else is in the restaurant when they're there. They close it down. It's open for them. We have to run your social security number. So I'm like, yeah, sure, man, do what you got to do. And all of us that agreed to work that day had our social security number run. The craziest thing that happened is our dishwasher, he ended up getting arrested by the Secret Service, and they did not feel like doing it because he had missed a parole, one of his, with the PO, whatever. He'd missed one of the meetings, which they have to file, and apparently that's a legality. And it was stemming from, like, shoplifting of, like, five Snickers bars maybe 5 years before that. So this dude, he had totally forgotten about it, put in a Social Security number, but Secret Service shows up. And they're like, we have to arrest what his name was. And we're like, for what? And they're like, dude, honestly, he missed one of his parole meetings with a freaking parole person, and we know what the crime is. I'm like, are you serious? And they even said, we don't feel like doing this, but we have to do it.
Anybody else has a protection order against them, Stamos just calls, FBI shows up.
Because it's Stamos.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it wasn't just Stamos. Like Julie Sweeney was saying, there was like creeps that would ask her for specific photos as her as a kid. She got death threats. She even at one point had to hire a former bodyguard of Henry Kissinger, who just passed away.
You've got to be like, man, they're making a dumb TV show. Leave them alone.
Well, that guy needed one.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's also just wild, too. Like I said, like we're all normal people. So you just watch shows and stuff. You never think about people getting that weird obsession and everything with like a famous person. You know what I mean? Like, look, there's famous people I would love to hang out with and kick it with them. But I feel like once you cross over into like this, well, obviously you start stalking people. That's a different thing.
That's a problem.
I'm sorry, Ted. I'm the guy petting your cats on the balcony.
That's an evil plan. I respect it, Montgomery. Just like soon, I just started putting cats out there.
Soon he'll be giving you kibbles and bits.
Trust me, those cats show up for crock pots just like my friends do.
Are you serious?
Oh, dude, if I've been cooking something all day, like so. Generally, if I have the blinders open. And they could see me, they start hanging out. But if I've had the crock pot going all day and I come home, I'll open the blinders. Dude, there's like two of them. They'll just be standing there.
Your new place. Are you kosher with a little propane grill you have?
Oh yeah.
Wait till you fire that up. You have friends for life. You should just put like a piece of tuna on there.
I'd say grill some tuna and see what happens.
Well, speaking of grills and crock pots. Obviously, big weekend for a lot of sports. Big weekend for college football. I'm sure a lot of people are paying attention to the Pac-12 championship game.
There's no one listening to us right now.
go ahead, drop an F-bomb. No one will care.
But also, look, if you're a college football junkie like me, like these are the sad times. Like we don't have many games left. Tomorrow, though, you'll have all the big conference championship games, Big Ten, ACC. The big one will be the SEC championship. That's Alabama and Georgia. Who knows? Depending on what happens in these games, could throw the whole college football playoff into chaos. Saturday Night Live, even though she's not my normal type, I do love her. Emma Stone is hosting SNL.
I like me some Emma Stone, man.
Yeah. Ted, I guess you're just ordering DoorDash.
You know what? Honestly, Miles, I made an executive decision, decided tonight would be the night to order a pizza because I will have some leftover for college football tomorrow.
That is vegan.
Pagliacci?
Yeah. I'm spending the big bucks getting the good stuff.
What did you get?
I haven't. Honestly, as soon as I'm done this segment, I'm going to eat an edible and order it.
Okay. Salad with the garbanzo beans.
Oh, you know that's getting ordered.
Actually, their dessert's pretty good too, man.
There is. But I mean, Sunday, I was going to say, also, go do some Christmas shopping this Sunday. The Seahawks already played this week, so you got a free Sunday. But some good games on, and the Packers Chiefs will be your nightcap.
Thank you, Tim. We appreciate it. You're listening to The Men's Room.
Selling a little or a lot? Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business. From the launch your online shop stage, to the first real-life store stage, all the way to the did we just hit a million orders stage. Shopify is here to help you grow. Whether you're selling scented soap or offering outdoor outfits, Shopify helps you sell everywhere. From their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system, wherever and whatever you're selling, Shopify has got
you covered. Shopify helps you turn browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout. 15% better on average compared to other leading commerce platforms. And sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the U.S. And Shopify is the global force behind Allbirds, Rothy's, and Brooklinen, and millions of other entrepreneurs of every size across 175 countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning 24/7 help is there to support your success every step of the way. Because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/odysseypodcast, all lowercase. Go to shopify.com/odysseypodcast now to grow your business, no matter what stage you're in. Shopify.com/odysseypodcast.
Felix, the only pet insurance plan just for cats. With plans starting at under $1 per day and as unique as your cat. You'll love them, and you can't imagine living without them. And as each and every one of your fur babies rubs against your leg, go ahead and tell them the exciting news. Felix Cat Insurance offers whisker-to-tail protection. The kind of protection that you both, or should we say all, deserve. Whether you've got an indoor cat, an outdoor cat, or they're a little of both, Felix Cat Insurance has you covered. Our curated cat insurance plans were designed to meet the special needs of your feline family members. Accidents, illnesses, cancer, diabetes, emergency care, alternative therapies, hereditary conditions, exam fees, and much more. Customizable coverage exclusively for felines. Sorry, no dogs allowed. FelixCatInsurance.com. Get it? Meow. Insurance is underwritten by Independence American Insurance Company and produced by Independence Pet Group. Pre-existing conditions are not covered. For all terms and limitations, visit felixcatinsurance.com/terms.
This holiday season, make your journey memorable with Travel Centers of America, where our motto is simple. Return every traveler to the road better than they came. Avoid any hassle and stop at our one-stop shop for all your holiday travel needs. Fuel up, indulge in delicious snacks, and dine at one of our full-service restaurants. Hit the road with peace of mind knowing we've got you covered. For more info, go to ta-petro.com. Travel Centers of America, your road to happy travels.
Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Florida man with no life is trying to collect 1 million copies of Titanic on VHS.
Cool.
Florida man with no life, he steals hundreds in Pokemon cards. And ladies, he will not impress. Woman steals $800 worth of Barbies before leading police on a high-speed chase. By the way, if you see a bear at a Quick Trip in Oregon, they say to give him space.
Yeah.
And shocking news is even a Baltimore City worker. Corrupt.
What?
Shocking. Time for headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the head. Lines. Here's Mike Hawk.
We're out of top, sir. We're going to Florida, of all places.
Florida.
It's usually
never in the news.
It's a very calm place. But anyway, there's a thief that's been thwarted, thank God. He was recently caught on surveillance at the local Walmart attempting to sneak items out of the store after he failed to scan them at a self-checkout stand, because Walmart's got the greatest quality products that you could ever ask for, man. He was caught with nearly $200 in unpaid merchandise and is now facing charges. Also, side note, when did Walmart start checking receipts at the door? When did they start going the Costco route?
Okay.
When they realized people were ripping. Did they say what the products were that he was taking?
Pokemon cards.
Jesus Christ, dude.
You have to remember, you guys know, like, you and Ted's excitement going into a Costco.
Sure.
We're in a major metropolitan area that has them. You have to be of a certain population to get them. Walmart is that option for 75% of the country.
Sure, sure.
No kidding?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely, dude.
I thought they were just everywhere, dude.
Have you ever been to Topeka?
No, what he's saying is
they have a Costco.
They're everywhere.
If you're outside of that, you're screwed.
They're everywhere, but they hit the rural communities where Costco would not be there.
Correct.
Sure.
Walmart is their go-to.
They're the everything.
I mean, I know that they are the superstore, and I get that. They are the place that has everything. I just figured that they truly were everywhere.
You know, I almost feel bad for Walmart, because it's not Walmart's fault that Walmart has its reputation.
Not at all.
It is the people that choose to populate Walmart. They end up giving it back. Walmart's just like, dude, we're a brick-and-mortar Amazon.
Right.
We're just here to give you
what you need. Walmart has an upper tier called Sam's Club.
Right.
They're not in those towns, so they don't even have that Costco alternative. If that makes sense.
Right.
So going to Walmart, like with my parents, with my mom, my grandmother. Oh, mom says she's going to take me to Walmart on Saturday. And that's a big deal.
Sure.
Because she can shop.
Right, because now
and they have all the
and
stuff.
And you can get everything that you need.
They have all the
everything
stuff.
Everything you need.
I even asked my wife earlier this week, I was like, do the people of Walmart know that there is a website completely devoted to them?
They might, but I get the feeling they don't know why they'd be featured on it.
Yes. Everyone sure. who has a mullet knows they have a mullet. It's the same thing.
Walmart also one of the only places you can, if you're like on a road trip, you could stay in your RV overnight in the parking lot.
And have your beer stolen and watch them drink it in front of you.
Stolen.
Yeah, Klamath Falls.
Salty Ted. Meanwhile, we go to Buffalo area Walmart, where real thieves roam. Authorities were alerted to a woman that reportedly walked out of the local Walmart with roughly $800 worth of merchandise. They did eventually track her car down on the roadway, but instead of yielding to police their lights and sirens, she decided instead to flee, reaching speeds of 100 miles per hour. No house on the back of this one. Considering the safety of bystanders, officers called off the chase, but quickly tracked down her location and moved in to arrest her, all in an attempt to steal $800 worth of Barbies.
Of course. And I do feel bad for people this time of the year, man. I do. Because a lot of the times, these thefts are not for them.
Sure.
They just want to make their kid happy, whatever. Absolutely. Look, if you commit a crime, man, you're still going to pay for it. But I'm like, I understand your motivation. I get why you're doing this. I get your desperation. And it sucks.
And I haven't checked. I also wouldn't be surprised. Has the price of Barbies gone up recently?
I don't know, but I would assume that it has because Barbie's been put back on the map in no way that she's ever been before.
Right. I mean, she never really left the map. Barbie has been the standard girl's doll, been the standard doll, period.
And look, I have not seen the movie yet, but from what I've read about the movie, Barbie, instead of being this thing you aspire to be as far as your looks,
right?
I guess based on the movie, and again, have not seen it, now she is the person you would aspire to be if you're a young woman, right?
Sure.
You can be gorgeous and blah, 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 but it's some sensibility about it.
Right.
So I think now she's become like a role model instead of something you're trying to chase.
Absolutely. Barbie was more of a... It was the
idealization of things.
Exactly. The one that had everything, the one that had
everything,
the car, had the dream house, had the vacations, had the friends, had the pool, had
Brazilian the, butt lift. Yeah,
absolutely.
All stuff.
God, can you imagine
Brazilian butt lift Barbie?
Oh. Barbie Barbie was so far ahead of the Brazilian. In my lifetime, she was the pioneer. She blazed the clean trail, and so did Ken. Don't give him.
Got it, Miles.
I'm serious. Like, she paved the way for what
I'm
we know to be.
I'm aware you're serious. All righty, men's room sports.
That's a worrisome.
If you're interested in Seattle sports, you are probably not listening to this program, or at least we're on in the background, and you're already watching the Pac-12 championship. Oregon taking on Washington. That's in Vegas. Is that correct, Ted?
That is correct.
Correct.
It's over on Channel 4. Let's go, Doug. Get her done. Also got a little NHL hockey over on NHL Network. You got some NBA basketball on ESPN, and FS1 has your college men's basketball. And ladies and gentlemen, that is it for your headlines. With that, go Dogs! Mike Hawk is out.
Thank you, sir, guys. Enjoy your weekend. We'll see you on Monday.
Yes, indeed. It's all true. In the meantime, well, we be all about this bitch for 180 seconds or so. So until then, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The men's room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.
I'm Snoop Dogg, and I'm giving up smoke. I know what you're thinking. Snoop, smoke is kind of your whole thing. But I'm done with it. I'm done with the coughing and my clothes smelling all funky. I'm going smokeless. Solo Stove Fixed Fire. They took out the smoke. Now you can have a nice blaze without any clouds ruining your day. Go smokeless. Go to solostove.com. Tell them Big Snoop Dogg sent you.
Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault?
Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Lovers, your local lingerie and adult store has gifts of pleasure for partners who know it's nice to be naughty. Turn up the heat this holiday when you shop at any Lovers store. Let our knowledgeable team help you select the best pleasure presents and save 20% on your purchase with Lovers Afterglow Rewards. Just mention LOVE20 at one of our 18 Western Washington locations. Offer valid with free Lovers Afterglow Rewards membership until December 31st. Some exclusions apply.
Deep underground, the Jelly Belly Factory, BB is in her secret laboratory creating the weird and wild flavors of Bean Boozled.
I've done it again!
Is it pomegranate or old bandage? Dare to compare. Bean Boozled, 6th edition. Are you brave enough?